Welcome everyone to the 11th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to have items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
We're agreed. Thank you. And our second item today is two evidence sessions as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And we'll hear from two panels of witnesses comprising organisations representing a combination of NHS primary care services in community settings and multidisciplinary teams in GP practices. And all our witnesses are participating remotely, as well as a good number of our MSP colleagues are also remote as well. For our first panel, though, a welcome to the committee, Claire Morrison, Director for Scotland, Royal Pharmaceutical Society; Julie Musgrove, the Vice Chair of Optometry Scotland; Harjeet Sandhu, the Managing Director for the National Community Hearing Association in Scotland; and Jess Sussman, the Policy Lead for the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland. So welcome to you all and good morning. Well, first of all, I think that one of the reasons why we decided on this inquiry was to draw attention to some of the services that were out there which people could be directed to or self-direct to in order to get specific primary care. And we wanted to have, I mean, certainly anecdotally we're hearing that there wasn't particularly a lot of public awareness about what was out there. And that's my first line of questioning. I really want to know from all of you, you know, that how difficult it is, or how difficult it has been, or how successful it has been in shifting that traditional view of you go to your GP for absolutely everything. So from your perspective, I would be interested to hear what you think that this, you know, this has been entrained for quite a few years now, this sort of like pathways system. How successful has it been, and what's the public awareness of it like? So if I maybe just go down in the way that I introduced you to Claire Morrison, first of all.
Thanks very much. And first of all, just to say that I'm here on behalf of the Royal Pharmaceutical Society. So we are pharmacy's professional leadership body. We have members in all sectors of the pharmacy, including community pharmacists, pharmacists working in GP practices, and pharmacists working in the wider NHS and education. So there are around 5,000 registered pharmacists in Scotland. We're a large professional group and the third biggest health profession after doctors and nurses. And as a professional leadership body, we really represent the individual pharmacists in their professional practice. So we don't represent commercial companies or contractual matters. To develop our written statement to the inquiry, we held focus groups to gather our members' views, and we also met with pharmacy leaders across Scotland. So we are representing a wider view. So I think to start off with, in answer to your question, I think it's really clear that pharmacy already provides a number of alternative pathways to GP care and primary care, and that's through community pharmacy services, through pharmacists working in GP practices, and also through specialist services in community settings. And pharmacists certainly have the professional ability to deliver more, but to achieve that, then capacity within pharmacy needs to be improved. And some key enablers there are around better skill mix, around developing the pharmacist workforce, specifically around independent prescribing and around better digital technology. But to answer your specific question about awareness, now I think both public and professional awareness of pharmacy is mixed. So certainly awareness of community pharmacies is high, but awareness of the professional roles and services that community pharmacists have is lower. Awareness of other pharmacists, such as those working in GP practices, is very low. So when you say pharmacy, people do tend to think that pharmacists' roles are very much about supplying medicines, but pharmacy is already much wider than that. So a third of pharmacists across NHS Scotland are actively prescribing medicines as independent prescribers, and that number is increasing all the time. So I think there is a lot of work to do to improve the understanding of pharmacy roles right now, and indeed the further extension to them.
Thank you. And I'll go to Julie Musgrove.
Hi there, Julie Musgrove, Vice Chair of Optometry Scotland. So we're a non-profit organisation representing optical sector, so that could be practices and it can also be the optometrists within the practice, dispensing opticians and other staff there as well. We've got over 900 providers across Scotland, so I'm just representing. So much like my colleague, optometry, just generally, we're on the high street, so we are very well known. You know, you can't walk down a local high street without seeing an optometry practice, much like a pharmacy practice. However, despite that, there was 2 million people attended for an eye exam in 2019. So there's still a lot of uptake that could be done there. Eye exams, traditionally, a lot of people think it's just to get your eyes tested. If you've got a problem with your vision, you go and see an optician then. But there's still quite a lot of work to be done on the awareness of what exactly can be picked up during a routine eye examination. Another thing as well as optometry, we became the first port of call for all eye emergencies. That is something, even with our other colleagues in dentistry, pharmacy, they're still building the awareness between that. So for any eye problem at all, rather than seeing a GP, it should be attending the optometry practice. There's been quite a lot of work that's been done over the years to try and kind of build relationships with that and also get that message across. Specifically in NHS Grampian, we did a campaign, which was a Know Who to Turn To, and that's been going on since 2009 to try and raise awareness in this. Posters were put up publicly, they were in GP practices, pharmacies, and just reaching out to try and advise where to turn to for the first kind of eye problems. But there's certainly still a lot of work that could be done from that side of things. We'll also provide domiciliary eye care, so that's something that I think it was 55,000 that attended for a domiciliary eye appointment in 2019. So there's still a lot of work that could be done to raise the awareness from that side for people at home unable to access the service. And then also on that, we have many optometrists coming through the ranks that are becoming independently prescribed. So they are able to prescribe a certain range of medication that are specific to their level of competency for patients. So we could be seeing more. We do have capacity. It's something we had prior to the pandemic, and it's something that we continue to have availability. We don't have a backlog like in secondary care. So it's something that we are on the high street and easily accessible, and we could just be promoting that more.
Thank you. And I'll come to Harjeet Sandhu.
Hey, it's a pleasure to be here today. Thank you for inviting us. I'm Harjeet Sandhu, representing audiology providers that work in primary care settings throughout Scotland. Our members work at over 150 locations and also provide home care. To answer the question, I think awareness is generally very limited for a lot of primary care professions, and largely because primary care is still very much framed as GPs rather than the wider primary care professions. So with respect to hearing care, general awareness about acting on hearing problems is relatively limited or poor in general society. Lots of people accept that their hearing problems are something that just happen with time. And therefore, there's a huge opportunity there to tackle what is a growing public health challenge. So just raising awareness of alternatives to GPs as primary care will also bring major benefits, we think, for population public health. But in order to tackle that general awareness, there has to be more of a communications strategy around removing this kind of concept that the GP is a single point of access. And I think the committee's evidence that it's got from the general public shows what the public really want is confidence that those alternative routes are planned routes rather than a sort of diversion routes or avoidance routes. And I think giving them the confidence that these are planned for them, for their benefit, and they're seeing the right person at the right time will be a key enabler.
Thank
That's
you.
That's all I have to say on this one.
Thank you. And can I come to Jess Sussman?
My name is Jess Sussman. I'm a consultant psychiatrist, and today I'm representing the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland. The psychiatry profession are experts at providing specialist, potentially life-saving care for mental illness within a clear ethical framework. Our focus is on delivering the best care and outcomes for patients. When looking to this consultation, we wanted to ensure that those with severe mental illness, those likeliest to need our care, are better able to access support and care in their communities. While recognising the importance of meeting the needs of all Scots, we believe that should involve our most vulnerable citizens, and that support should not cater simply to the majority of people who may have poor mental well-being and or mild to moderate mental ill health. while recognising that those with need of clinical interventions can and should be engaged in health services, we also recognise that there are those in our community who found traditional methods of accessing healthcare services uncomfortable, meaning they didn't present until their mental ill health had reached a severe stage. Our previous campaign focused on the need for there to be no wrong door to access the right care in the right place and at the right time for mental ill health. Ensuring the pathways into care from our communities are as accessible as possible is a critical aspect of delivering on this vision. We welcome the opportunity to discuss how we can better meet the needs of all who may interact with our primary care and community supports, and how these pathways can be adaptive to the needs of all Scots, including those with severe mental illness. And to answer your first question, we felt that there was a varying level of knowledge amongst practitioners, and for patients it was felt that many access using traditional methods, and that's their decision to access that way is defined by factors like their culture, geography, health awareness, and the availability of signposting information. But we also recognise the need for alternative pathways. As I said earlier, that there are those who feel in our community feel very uncomfortable accessing traditional pathways, and so did not present until they were very unwell with their mental health needs. We have long-standing examples of those from the past, and so it's critical that we find other ways to help those individuals come into the service and get the support they need at an earlier stage. In relation to alternative settings, we felt there were many that you could engage with alongside traditional ones, and religious settings were cited as an example, with some communities seeking religion as an avenue to get mental health support. And we also felt that community resources were worth considering for this purpose, including sort of social capital assets like youth groups. But our concerns from a practitioner perspective was the lack of stability of funding for community and social supports, meaning that the landscape is constantly changing. The, you know, I can cite examples in Hoyk of a wonderful art group that when the funding ceased, it collapsed, and then we didn't know what resources were available that would be equivalent to that in the local community. So it's about having a constant ear to the ground and having to maintain a knowledge of quite a flexible and fluctuating setting. Thank you.
Thank you. You've all individually raised some points that I was I'm interested to follow up a bit about. I mean, first of all, Harjeet Sandhu said about home care. And I think that's something that I hear from constituents that you traditionally have been able to have home visits, in the distant past from GPs. It was fairly regular thing. It's a very irregular thing. It has to be really quite a serious situation. But you mentioned home visits as something that's been part of your normal practice. And I don't think that people are aware of that, that they could have alternative pathways actually, you know, come into their home. Could you maybe expand on that?
Yeah, I was just waiting to be unmuted. I'm happy to go first as audiology. Most of the significant, most severe hearing problems occur in older age. So people who are more likely to have a hearing problem of greater severity are likely to be 80 and over. And therefore, some of the most unmet need in our society is in care homes and in populations whereby people find it difficult with mobility, etc., to travel. And therefore, there is a large offering, unfortunately, in Scotland, mainly from the independent sector, private sector, to deliver that home care service where you can have hearing diagnostics and testing and care and aftercare at home. So there is that inequality, and it's something that really needs to be addressed, but it is available and it is readily available. If I hand over, well, I think optometry is a little bit different in the NHS sense, but they might explain that to you, because yeah. Julie also mentioned home care.
Yeah, she did. I'm going to come to Julie on that. I mean, but Harjeet, you're saying that at the moment that's real mainly in the private sector, but it's something that could be expanded. Just to
absolutely,
yeah, okay, absolutely. I understand that. Yeah. I'll come to Julie now, yeah, from the optometry point of view.
Thanks. Yeah, so with optometry, it is available now. It's not across every optical provider. It's something that there are kind of specialised kind of practitioners that are doing it across. But it's a difficult one, just with, I think, the biggest barrier is the funding for it. It's keeping it a viable service, making sure, you know, it's accessing with a lot of travel. It's not just visiting care homes, it's also visiting individuals in their homes scattered across Scotland. So specifically remote and rural, it'd be a lot more difficult if you're driving to someone's house. But that's the barrier of it. But we do certainly offer the service across different providers. And as I said, in the 2019, out of the 2.1 eye exams, there was only 55,000 who actually accessed the home service.
So again, it comes down to communication from the point of view of Optometry Scotland, but in audiology, there's another issue there about the funding. Emma Harper wanted to come in and pick up on particularly on the point she made around geography and rural. But I should mention, before I hand over to Emma, I've got the chat box in the platform that you're on open. So if anyone wants to come in on anything specifically, go to the chat box and put an R then, and then I can see it and make sure that I bring you in. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody. Just to pick up on what Julie said about remote and rural, I mean, as far as optometrists are, we've got places in our small towns and large villages and to access optometry, for instance. But the remote and rural areas, obviously, there's going to be additional challenges. So I'm wondering, Julie, can you outline some what are the challenges are for remote and rural areas if we're going to look at delivering, I suppose, alternative pathways or having people access alternative pathways?
Yeah, sure. I think in optometry at the moment, I mean, it's well placed. There is a good network. I think when you look at the Highlands as an example, it's over about 60,000 people that if you were to travel to the Braidmore Hospital, they live over, say, 30 miles away from Braidmore. All the 60,000 people actually have an optometrist within a 30-mile geography of their homes. So it is well placed, but we need to be able to sustain that going forward, especially just with vacancies that come up. They can be more difficult to fill in these remote and rural locations. But I think it's, at the moment, there are issues with some areas of vacancies, but it's more the ongoing community eye care at the moment. It's making sure that a good supply of professional staff is still coming through, you know, to fill these positions. And something like future support would definitely help to mitigate this risk. At the moment, if you're looking at putting optometrists into more difficult locations that are harder to fill, often it's higher salaries that incur with that as well. So that makes it a more difficult service.
Just and another wee question. Previously, we've talked about like additional skills to deliver additional services. For instance, like in one of our members' debates, we spoke about how optometrists are often the first people that would detect type 2 diabetes. And so that would then lead to a referral to get blood glucose check. Is that something that could be potentially delivered in an optometry setting, but that would require additional skill, training and competence, for instance?
Yeah, so, I mean, diabetes at the early stages can be picked up by any optometrist right now. There's certain signs with diabetes that we can be looking for at the back of the eye. And I've had patients myself that I've seen in practice who've come in with no symptoms at all. And I've noticed changes at the back of the eye, and it's suggested they've got diabetes or high blood pressure. So I've advised them to go and see their GP and shown them the signs. And many of them have been quite shocked because, as I say, they've come in for a routine and actually didn't know they had symptoms. And they've sometimes been a bit dubious until they've seen their GP and then come back and said, I have been diagnosed with diabetes or blood pressure. That's something that can already be picked up, but certainly ongoing, once someone has been diagnosed with diabetes, it's the follow-on care they need as well. So it's assessing them regularly. They get regular eye exams, and a lot of that at the moment is in secondary care environments. There are areas like Ayrshire and Arran do diabetic screenings. They were seen in a community by an optometrist. And like you said, that is with additional training so that someone is able to kind of monitor and look for changes there. So it does require a little bit more equipment and a bit of training as well. But that is something that is happening in different pockets across Scotland. But unfortunately, not everywhere. It's in just in certain areas.
And can I bring in Claire Morrison, who wants to pick up on your question around remote and rural? Claire.
Yeah, so to add, really, in terms of remote and rural, community pharmacies are very much in our communities right across Scotland, and that includes remote and rural communities. And indeed, the accessibility of community pharmacies is something that I think the public is really aware of, and particularly during the COVID pandemic, when community pharmacies did indeed keep their doors open and were one of the services that was very much there. And I've lived and worked in the Highlands for the past 17 years, and both in terms of community pharmacy coverage, but also in terms of some of the more innovative practice that has taken place in pharmacy around pharmacists working in and with GP practices right across rural areas. And so we see all but 7 GP practices across the country having input from pharmacists through the pharmacotherapy service. So that, again, it covers all the rural practices, and that includes both in-person but also use of remote support as well. And finally, I'd just like to highlight some data from a recent Ipsos Mori survey, which was a survey of 1,107 adults in Scotland. And they were asked about methods of accessing pharmacy services. And what was really interesting with that was that 87% said they wanted to access pharmacy services in person. So that's great, because we've got that coverage there already. But actually, there was a lot of people who said they wanted to access pharmacy services in other ways. So 59% talking about telephone consultations, 42% talking about video consultations, and 38% and other digital services such as online messaging. So I think all of those ways enable improving access to people in remote and rural areas, alongside having people travel and provide services in the location. Thank you.
And Harjeet Sandhu wants to come in on this.
Yeah, just to build on Claire's point, one is that today we also have innovative technologies in hearing care, where you can fine-tune remotely people's digital hearing aids to help them hear better, so they don't have to travel as far for every single visit. But there's also this quite large primary care infrastructure across Scotland, which is not yet mobilised always by the NHS Commission services in quite the same way as the primary care professions. So there is a huge opportunity to tackle those inequalities and access that exist in rural communities, reducing the cost on the individuals of travelling quite long distances sometimes to access care. So I just want to mention the opportunities here in terms of reducing inequalities and access.
I'm going to bring in a couple of my colleagues. Stephanie, you wanted to come in on the diabetes aspect that Emma mentioned. Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan, and then I'll come to Sandesh Kohani? Stephanie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just a quick follow-up with Julie there. Just when she was speaking about diabetes and being able to actually spot this really early on, she spoke about referring to GPs, and I'm wondering whether or not she would also refer direct to other primary care pathways, or indeed to specialists, or whether or not that would be appropriate. I'm just kind of trying to figure out how it fits together, and whether it always has to go back to the GP, or whether there can be onward referral that actually kind of skips that step if it's unnecessary. Thanks.
Thanks, Stephanie. Julie.
Yeah, I suppose, thanks for the question. I suppose it depends on the condition. So I suppose with diabetes, it would actually probably be the nurse that we would refer to for it to get bloods checked, like blood pressure check. So it probably would be the nurse that we go to with that. There are other conditions that we can pick up as well. So I suppose if we're suspecting the patient's had a stroke, then we'd be referring through the GP. But if it's affected the eyes as well, we'd also be contacting the hospital. We also refer to pharmacy for certain conditions as well. So it depends on the condition, but the majority of our referrals would either go to a GP or direct to the hospital. It's probably the majority. There are other things we can do as well with our sector organisations.
That's really helpful to know that. I think that those referral pathways work actually within primary care services and beyond that as well. That's great. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. I want to talk a bit about innovative practice that we heard a bit earlier, especially in rural areas. And I know of some amazing work that's been done in NHS Grampian. And I'd really like Julie Musgrove to tell us a little bit more about it, and also barriers to rolling this out Scotland-wide, and whether anyone else has any examples of innovative work around rural areas that makes life better for our patients.
We'll go to Julie first of all, since you mentioned Julie.
Perfect, thank you. In Grampian, I'm based up in Grampian and I've worked within the system for over 10 years now. So the Grampian Eye Health Network, we set that up, it was 2007 that set up, and that was ahead of the rest of Scotland being the first port of call for all eye emergencies. And the reason it was set up was the fact that when they did an audit on the eye outpatient department, found that 10%, well, less than 10% of walk-ins actually required to see an ophthalmologist. So it was finding that ophthalmologists were seeing all sorts of conditions that actually we could have seen ourselves in primary care. So this model was kind of built up around four main conditions that were eye-related emergencies, but from there has grown just in collaboration with, well, working with secondary care and also GP practices as well. So there are optometrists out there with, well, within Grampian, they have a network where we can prescribe for a range of conditions. That is something that we don't need to be an independent prescriber for. So from 2007, we were able to prescribe certain medication for patients, take them in practice, monitor them in practice, and then get them back for review appointments, whereas those patients would have originally gone up to the hospital to be seen. So some of the conditions are simple, like foreign body removal. An optometrist would be trained in Grampian to remove that. Whereas if you were in Tayside, you would potentially be going into the hospital in Tayside to get something removed from your eyes in an A&E department. So there's things like that. But likewise, there's also some medical conditions that have been work in support with a GP. Now, with more and more independent prescribers, we can prescribe that ourselves without having to co-prescribe with a GP. But in Grampian, any optometrist has been able to do that. I know there are pockets across Scotland, especially in remote and rural areas, where they have that good network with the GP and also with the hospital, because it requires the ophthalmology support there as well to help us support the patient in the best way. There is different networks, but that is probably one of the best ones there.
And Claire Morrison wanted to come in on this, Sandesh.
So I think one of the services I would draw attention to is a consulting service, which actually the very early pilot of which took place in pharmacy services in NHS Highland. And indeed in other pockets across the country as well. And one of the reasons for that was around an ability to provide remote pharmacists and support into really rural areas where there wasn't a community pharmacy. So really, really isolated communities in Northwest Sutherland, for example, and some island populations as well. And what those services enabled using NIMI, which is obviously now during the pandemic was scaled up significantly and is available right across NHS Scotland, but actually that service enabled patients to have complex medication reviews remotely. And one of the great things is that you can hold up your tablets and on a video camera, so you don't have to be able to pronounce the names, which can be a barrier for some people, and also to be able to see into people's homes and support them with taking their medicines effectively. So definitely we've seen innovation with technology in rural areas like that. Thank you.
Before I move on to more questions from my colleagues, I wanted to ask Jess Sussman something, because we hear as constituency and regional MSPs about long waiting times to access mental health care. From your perspective as a psychiatrist, there may be people watching this and listening to what you've said before saying, well, I thought I always would have to be referred to any kind of mental health care. Can you give us an idea of how the public would access the services that you're talking about? You have mentioned us about outreach stuff that you've been doing, but could you maybe give us a bit of a flavour about, just for the public out there, where is their sort of self-referral, or where's that doorway into services that you describe?
So a great example is the primary care mental health teams in Glasgow, where you can self-refer in, and now I understand that about 46% of referrals are self-referrals. And that would be for an assessment really of your well-being and whether or not you have a mild to moderate mental health problem. And if they felt that there was something more serious going on, they would refer to secondary care. So that's a good example of a primary care setting.
Right, but that's in Glasgow. I mean, that's another example of good practice, but it's obviously not rolled out nationwide, no?
No, and this is the difficulty, isn't it? So it depends. This is one of the issues around signposting and understanding of the options related to how severe your illness is. So what we want to ensure is that there's a straightforward pathway when you're severely unwell through the GP to get to the appropriate specialist psychiatric care. But when the condition is different, it's maybe mild to moderate, then there should be a variety of options available in the community that people could choose between to maximise their health and their well-being, and to improve upon things sort of anxiety management style, relaxation opportunities, for improving access to other people, to peer support. These kinds of things need to be available locally, and they aren't. It's very postcode lottery at the moment about what is available where and how those things are sustained. Mm. And good examples.
Carry on. I don't want to interrupt you.
I was going to give a good example of a resource that has been wonderful in the Borders. That's where I work, NHS Borders, is the Men's Shed, which is an example of an organisation for men. At the moment, it's mainly older men who choose to access it, and it's peer support, it's woodwork. They do all sorts of interesting things depending on the area and depending on what the individual groups want to achieve. And that's about well-being and maintaining health, and possibly, you know, mild to moderate when you're not feeling fantastic, going there and talking it through with peers and getting that kind of support. It's a different level to the level of needing to see the GP and then needing onward referral to psychiatric services.
Yeah, and I know that you wanted to join in on the responses to Sandesh's question, which brought up Near Me.
Yes, my point about Near Me was more, so I'm also a rehabilitation psychiatrist, so my main job is looking after people with chronic schizophrenia, people who are never entirely recovered from their illness in terms of symptoms and onward difficulties. And while Near Me is a fantastic resource for many, I would say that actually none, I can't think of a single patient in my rehabilitation service who would feel comfortable using an online service to access any support, really. They all have wanted, all the way through COVID, they've wanted and needed face-to-face contact. And those that have chosen not to have it through anxiety around COVID have become unwell, and then we've had to reinstate face-to-face contact.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to come on to questions from Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Is the panel concerned that the NHS will be able to recruit sufficient staff to fulfil the ambitions set out in the NHS Recovery Plan and the National Workforce Strategy for Health and Social Care? How likely is it that staff will be redeployed or recruited from elsewhere to fill gaps?
And who would you like to direct that to first? Will we go to Claire Morrison first, Gillian?
I think that would be a good idea. Yes, thanks, convener.
Thank you. Claire.
So like every other profession, pharmacy is, of course, at the moment in difficulty in terms of total workforce capacity. But what I would say is there are some things that could be done to improve both our capacity and our culture in our workforce that could lead to an increased capacity of staff. So some of the things that we need to do are things like making our processes more efficient in all settings. So right now we have poor information flow in and out of community pharmacy, which adds an awful lot of work of time into professionals' days. We have the pharmacotherapy service in GP practices, where there's real variation, for example, in terms of dealing with acute request prescriptions. And again, improving some of that could create capacity within the system. We have a lack of digital tools, so introducing an electronic single shared patient record to improve capacity, quality and safety and underpin all the referrals that we've talked about already would create significant time savings in both community pharmacy and in general practice pharmacy as well. We could also do more to invest in skill mix in pharmacy, so investing in more pharmacy technicians and more pharmacy support workers in order to release pharmacist capacity. We could do more to modernise the dispensing process in pharmacy, and we could look at digital tools such as electronic prescribing as well. So there is work going on in all of these areas, but We need to accelerate all of that, and we need much better workforce planning. And I think that's really one of our concerns, is that pharmacy needs workforce planning by government in the way that it's done for doctors and nurses, and it isn't done for pharmacists and pharmacy technicians in the same way at the moment. Very aware that we can't create an additional workforce. It takes many years to train a pharmacist. And so actually, what are some of the things that we can do right now? And I think focusing on some of those capacity issues would be really beneficial now, focusing on workforce planning while we look at training more people in the longer term. Thanks.
And I'll bring in Julie Musgrove.
Hi, it's great to be unmuted. So I think with us for workforce planning and optometry, it's something a lot of optical businesses have been having to do this to in order to attract optometrists, dispensing opticians to the practices. And one of the things we do is attend local schools for careers events, talking about optometry. I personally found myself when I decided to become an optometrist, it was only because I got my eyes tested and actually needed glasses. And that completely shifted my thought. I have thought of it as a career choice. It was more medical, looking at like doctors, dentists, things like that. So optometrists is raising the awareness at school level to attract more people to university. In Scotland now, I mean, we only had Glasgow Caledonian University up until very recently. And now we have University of Highlands and Islands and started optometry as well. But those graduates haven't come out yet. So there's two universities now offering optometry. Because obviously when people come out of university, they tend to stay closer to the university that they studied in. So there's a hope that the UHI will help to keep optometrists in that sector. Overall, there's an increase in patient volumes, the same as every kind of sector as well with the ageing population. And I suppose a barrier with it as well is just that the investment in staff is becoming greater over the years. So that's going to be something just is the funding stream going forward to ensure we can protect the workforce going forward, but there's certainly a lot more that can be done and a lot more raising awareness. But it's starting young and working up to get people into the sector.
And can I come to Harjeet Sandhu?
Yeah, thank you for the question. The NHS recovery plan specifically mentions audiology and making it evolving it to be on par with the rest of primary care, and that means greatly expanding access. In order to do that, the current NHS workforce, which is predominantly hospital-based, won't be able to meet that need. But fortunately, you can double the workforce by using other primary care professions in the same way as optometrists, GPs and pharmacists are used. In fact, many hundreds of audiologists work in the same practices as optometrists and pharmacists today throughout Scotland. So there's definitely both the workforce and the infrastructure there to deliver that part of the NHS recovery plan. So that's an audiology perspective.
And I'll come to Jess Sussman.
Thank you for the question. From our perspective, I mean, I think, like, as everyone else is saying, that there are crises of staffing, within mental health, nursing staff, social workers, pretty much across the board, we have problems at the moment filling all the necessary roles. But we really welcome the expansion of link workers into primary care settings and in the borders. We also have local area coordinators, to help folk with mental health problems to be able to navigate and within their local communities the resources that are available. So having someone there who can spend time with them and understand, which requires a real set of skills to engage with folk with difficulties with their mental health, and then to be able to signpost them and support them to access different resources in the community and alternate pathways, it is very much welcome. But we are also concerned that unless there's a real sort of look at the workforce and how you plan for it, then it's going to be taking skilled staff from within other settings and just moving them across, creating other gaps.
Thank you. Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. The public knows that the NHS has been under extreme pressure for the last 2 years, and as we hear more about the impact this is taking on staff, is there a risk that this will impact recruitment? How do we persuade people that the NHS, primary care and the sectors that you all work in and represent are still great places to work and continue to attract people into health professions? And could I maybe go to Julie first on this, please?
So an opportunity for a recruitment drive right now offered to you by Gillian Mackay. I'll go to Julie Musgrove first of all.
I think it's important that times are changing and a lot of people are looking for more of a work-life balance as well. So that is certainly going to create a challenge from a recruitment point of view, is making sure there's more people coming through. Certainly in optometry, we found that people have looked at changing their working hours, maybe doing less days, then maybe dropping to 4 days compared to five. And certainly it's something that we just have to be mindful of as we are just recruiting generally, but also putting people through the courses, university being more open to this as well, because we need to be flexible and not trying to keep people set in the role that it maybe was. And then that will help to keep the balance better there as well, attract people to stay in the roles. But it's just providing that support. You know, employers generally are, it's one of those things to look after the staff and make sure everyone is posted, to make sure they've got the support they have. Certainly there's different kind of mental health support out there as well. And that's certainly, the pandemic has taken its toll on a lot of people. So it's having those access to services. And it is something that has kind of come out of the pandemic, is that people have, and certainly employers are accessing these services more and letting them available to employees to better support their staff. But it's important that we modify how we look at recruiting and what we're willing to offer as well.
Gillian, I'm not seeing anyone else wants to come in on that particular question. Have you got a follow-up at all, Gillian?
There's a couple of ours just popped into the chat box.
Oh, is there? Right, my heavy hit yes. has worked. I'll go to Claire Morrison first.
Too slow. First thing I would say is I think pharmacy can be a bit of a hidden profession. So it would be a fantastic thing if we could have a recruitment drive in order to promote careers in pharmacy. And I'm not just about pharmacists, but also some of the other really important roles there are around pharmacy technicians and pharmacy support workers as well. So that would be fantastic. And I think there is very much something about talking about and increasing public awareness of the types of roles that exist in pharmacy as well. And so thinking about things like the NHS Pharmacy First Service and Community Pharmacy, and thinking about the pharmacotherapy service developments in GP practices, and how educating and giving awareness to people about those types of service is almost certainly would make pharmacy seem like a more attractive career proposition. And the other thing is that I think we do need to work with pharmacy employers to improve some of the culture around things like flexible working opportunities and certainly having a rest break during the working day. And that still is a really important issue in community pharmacy in particular, where there can be an expectation to work from 8 in the morning to 6 at night without a single rest break at all. And that is a challenge for us. So I think there's lots that can be done by working with pharmacy employers. And then finally, as a professional leadership body, and part of our role is around creating a positive vision for the future. And we recently published Pharmacy 2030, which is our professional vision. And that is really about maximising and making the absolute best of what makes pharmacy unique, which is our expertise in medicines. And so being able to describe an exciting career prospect for people in that way, I hope would attract more people into the profession. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll go to Harjeet Sandhu.
Yeah, I think this question goes to the heart of the inquiry as well. At the moment, the public very much appreciate GPs to the point that they're very upset, clearly, in the service user feedback when they can't access the GP. And it builds on what Claire said. People just don't recognise sometimes just how valuable the other primary care family is. And by raising the profile over those other professions, I think naturally we'll see more people interested in those careers. For example, in audiology, where audiologists can do ever more extended services, wax management, supporting people with counselling for tinnitus, and really helping people with that long-term hearing loss. I think the more awareness we raise, the more exciting and fulfilling these careers, you know, will be. And not only hopefully will we attract people, but we'll keep them in the professions for longer. So I think hopefully this will help. This will be part of the solution.
Thank you. And Jess Sussman.
I think I want to echo what everybody else has said, but I also think that, you know, the value of a person-centred sort of and helping career is so important to people, and the connection with others and that we've lost some of that with the isolation of the digital model at the moment. I appreciate we're getting back into it, thank God, but there'll be more hybrid working. But I think working remotely has really harmed people's relationships and their sense of being part of a team and part of a group. And that we need to recover from that a little bit. But also the development of the career, whether it's nursing, whether it's audiology or other careers, the opportunity to develop and different roles and specialisms is vital to recruitment, I think, that people feel they can move in a direction positively over their lifetime of their career.
Thank you.
Those are the things I wanted to add.
Thank you very much. Gillian, are you happy for me to move on to Sue's follow-up question?
Yep, happy to move on, convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Gillian. Sue? I'll just go over to Sue. There we are. Oh, we don't appear to be able to hear Sue. I wonder if I can't see that Sue is muted, so I'm wondering if there's an issue there. Maybe just give it a wee minute for broadcasting to switch it off, switch it on again type thing. No, I think Sue has frozen. Maybe if Sue wants to rejoin, maybe. And I'll come back to you, Sue. Don't worry about that. If you want to rejoin, or broadcasting can get in touch with Sue and sort out those technical problems. Right, we'll move on and then I'll come back to Sue's question on workforce planning once she's back. David Torrens, over to you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel members. Does the primary care system enable a holistic and preventive approach to keeping people well? And I'll go to Claire first, please.
So I think a really important role of pharmacists is that they do provide person-centred care and they do provide a holistic approach. So rather than looking at someone in terms of just a specific clinical condition, they are looking at the medicines in an entirety. And I think that we need to do more to ensure that person-centred approach is taken right across primary care. But absolutely, I think that pharmacists play an important part of that. And I'd just like to highlight some data from of public opinion in terms of the recent Ipsos Mori survey that I mentioned earlier, because their views on the roles of pharmacists included 95% supporting pharmacists advising on medicines, 87% thinking it was important that pharmacists prescribe medicines, 89% thinking pharmacists should be the first port of call for common clinical conditions, and 81% thinking that pharmacists should be monitoring, reviewing and adjusting medicines for long-term conditions. So all of that really kind of feeds into the public engaging with pharmacists on providing that holistic care to people's conditions in the entirety.
Julie Musgrove.
Just add to that, you know, optometry practices are welcoming places and they normalise healthcare, so a holistic approach is something that we would take anyway. You know, patients sit with an optometrist for on average about half an hour, and during that time, you know, we're delving to find out what's the reason for them coming in, are they having any issues, and it's delving into different areas of their life as well. You know, what do they use their eyes for, the working, is it, you know, you're on a computer all day, you know, what's your hobbies and interests like, you know, it's a very kind of dynamic, important, it's not just solely focusing on one medical condition, we're looking for a range of conditions and we're also looking for a range of visual requirements to see, you know, delving into what this patient needs. So I think the holistic side is, well, we're talking about general health, we're talking about smoking, so there's lots of different areas with that as well. As I say, it's very similar to pharmacy, it's not pinpointing into a specific thing as such, it's looking at the whole patient.
Okay, and I'll go to Harjeet Sandhu.
I think it's answer your question in two ways. One, does each of the professions focus on prevention? I think they do a relatively good job. Is there interprofessional communication to maximise the prevention and public health elements? I'm not so sure. If we take audiology, for example, people with hearing loss at increased risk of depression, dementia, social isolation, and other mental health risks, and yet we have hundreds of thousands of people in Scotland going to see their GP who aren't referred for an intervention for hearing loss to prevent those risks. We have hundreds of thousands of people that are seeing pharmacy colleagues where that difficulty in hearing isn't picked up. So I think there's a huge amount of opportunity, if you like, to really benefit from prevention by that interconnectedness across primary care. And hopefully these kind of inquiries really help the interconnectedness and the onward referral to really benefit from that massive public health gain we can get, which I think is at the heart of what the Audit Commission recently said about really putting the NHS on a sure footing is really going upstream and doing more out of hospital. And I think so there's huge opportunities there.
Thank you. And Jess Sussman.
I think if we're talking about prevention specifically, then we have to look more widely at socioeconomic issues as well. The communities most likely to develop mental health difficulties are those communities with the most challenging socioeconomic status. But in terms of holistic approach within the mental health profession, I think we do not just focus clinically on people and their illnesses and their illness models, but we also look more broadly at how they can best integrate into communities, have a better social, economic, social, occupational and educational opportunities once they're well enough to achieve those. And then it's about the alternative pathways that they can access to best make use of those and the support they need to access those.
David, Emma wants to pick up on something that Jess has just said, and I'll come back to you, Emma. Emma Harper. Bring your mic up. Sorry, that doesn't seem to be. Can we bring Emma's microphone up, please? Broadcasting. It does not appear to be coming on.
No.
No. We've got gremlins today.
Oh, there you go.
There we are.
Great, thank you. It's just to pick up on what Jess said and relating back to what she said earlier about art and supporting that. I had a case where someone was exploring self-directed support and they wanted the money to be used for art, which was going to help them tackle social isolation, but it was refused because it was art and it was seen that it wasn't important. So I suppose in Jess's experience, how would you feel about something that actually would benefit a person to tackle their social isolation? Art therapy is really, really good. I see you shaking your head. What would be your thoughts on that?
Absolutely. I'm very surprised. I have patients who have used self-directed support, SDS, to get and have had an art teacher come to their homes, spend time with them there, with patients with chronic schizophrenia. And I would absolutely support all of those resources being used in that way. The difficulty that we had through COVID with self-directed support was that unlike the council-led care structures, which kept going to a degree during the early stages of COVID, lots of the self-directed support just disappeared. And that was one of the difficulties. Much as it's a wonderful thing to have the opportunity to choose your supports, that is wonderful. It also needs to be solid and to be present in different circumstances. And that was one of the difficulties that we were aware of.
Thank you.
I think it is a fabulous thing that you can access and organise the supports that you want. And lots of our patients need help with that, quite a lot of help. Mm-hmm. And our social workers will help them access SDS through organisations like Encompass, the Borders. But yes, it's been a problem during times of COVID.
Okay. I'll come back to David Torrance to follow up on your question, David.
Thank you, Convener. To what extent are primary healthcare practitioners, other than GPs, able to promote prevention and self-management? And is there a greater focus needed on prevention? And I'll go to Chloe first. Clear, sorry.
You're over to you.
I think pharmacy does quite a lot on prevention, particularly when we look at some of the public health services that are available in community pharmacies. So these are contracted services around things like sexual health services, smoking cessation. There are locally agreed services such as injection equipment provision. And indeed, also there's prevention in terms of talking to people about their wider health as part of of supplying medicines. So I think pharmacy tries to deliver prevention services where the contractual framework has enabled that community pharmacy. And I think the other thing really just to pick up on it is the pharmacy first service. So that, again, a really important service in terms of being available from all community pharmacies, where pharmacists are providing advice and treatment for common clinical conditions. And sometimes some of that kind of management that happens can help prevent people then developing or their condition and worsening and them needing a GP care as well. So actually, I think there is quite a bit that's happening, but of course, there's always more that can be done.
Thank you. And I'll come to Harjeet Sandhu.
I would say audiology is fundamentally a prevention service. When an audiologist sees a service user, what they're really doing is limiting the impact of the hearing loss on communication, and then all the benefits that flow from that, such as reducing the risk of social isolation and mental ill health. The challenge that we really have is those types of prevention are not what make the headline. Normally the types of prevention that make the headlines are preventing stop smoking and so on, these very high level interventions. Whenever you look at prevention strategies that come from government, they're always there. However, with the aging population, what we'd very much like to see is an active aging strategy. And within that, I think we see whole new prevention opportunities to help our population age well, rather than just preventing the primary preventive sort of public health measures. So as part of active aging, there's huge opportunities again. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. We'll go to Jess Sussman.
About sort of rethinking prevention in mental health, because our population fluctuates in terms of their illness, and actually accessing the right resource at the right time prevents a deterioration that could be long-lasting and have major impacts on their futures. So it's about the stability of resources that are available in the community, that are the alternative pathways again, that need to sort of stand stable. And it's about accessing services when you need them at speed, and for those services to be well resourced.
Mm-hmm. And finally on this, I'll come to Julie Musgrove.
Thank you. Probably just to follow on from what Harjeet Sandhu said, it's optometry and audiology can be very similar from this respect of we are predominantly preventative eye care. So routine eye care is just generally over half the patients that we're attending for eye exam in 2019 were responding to a recall from already being seen 1 year or 2 years prior. The eye exam in itself, we're taking photos of the back of the eye, we're documenting what we're seeing. So a lot of it is routine appointments, and then we are monitoring things over time. So it might just be that we're monitoring a healthy eye every 2 years. We're having discussion around health generally, so whether it's smoking, exercise, protecting your eyes against the UV, eating a well-balanced diet, and also this is well, so how are people's families' eyes, is there any conditions that run in the family that can affect the eyes, so that it is predominantly preventative. I think what we can often end up being reactive to things, and let's say a part of what we do is reactive, but I would say eye care on the whole is predominantly preventative looking ahead.
Thank you. And Jess Sussman wants to come back in. Jess.
Thank you. Yes, I suppose I also wanted to say, thinking about it from the optometrist and audiologist perspective as well, that with severe mental illness comes a much greater risk of physical health problems, so weight issues, diabetes, and increased smoking. And these things need specific resources sort of for engagement for our patients specifically, who need additional time, additional understanding to build trust with the person supporting them to get the tests and to get the support that they need, the input and care that they need. And so, again, that needs to be thought about in terms of the pathways.
Thank you. We have got Sue Weber back. I'm going to jump back into the workforce issues theme that we had been discussing when we had issues. I'm just double checking you're here. Sue, over to you. Oh dear, we still can't hear you. My goodness. Right, in that case, Sandesh Gulhani has said that he'll be your wingman on this occasion and will ask your question.
Always, convener. So this really is for, to start with, for Claire from... it's about MDT, and it's really looking at talking about in terms of data to drive decisions. And with all members of allied healthcare professionals to be included fully in the workforce plan, what would need to happen for you to get appropriate data, for you to get the right things? Because obviously, in terms of training and financial support, a lot of groups are different businesses. But you need access to patient data to be able to perform the function.
Right. Well, I think we'll just go down the list. If we maybe go to Claire Morrison, first of all. And if anyone else wants to come in, please use the chat box.
So the thing that could be absolutely transformational in terms of enabling that multidisciplinary team working is a single shared electronic patient record. So right now, information is held in silos right across health and care, and all professionals waste time chasing information. There's a safety risk of not having the relevant information when you're making a clinical decision. And there is an enormous duplication of effort when we think about things like medicines reconciliation, that process of every time someone, a patient moves between care settings, such as on admission to hospital or discharge back to primary care, then the professionals have to check multiple sources of information to ensure they've got the right list of patients' medicines. They have to update the records that they keep. And if we had a single shared record where every professional entered information and every professional read the information, it would eliminate all of that work, it would make care safer. And the kind of shared record that we're talking about is an appropriate view. So everyone writes in and everyone can read what is appropriate to their role. So we're not talking about a record that is with all information available to every profession, but actually about what's the relevant information for this professional to have in order to be able to provide that safe and effective care for the patient. So I think it would be transformational. And I think to really enable that working in terms of both having the information, but also the communication as well. So if you see a patient in a community pharmacy setting, you prescribe a medicine for that patient, and then it could be that the patient then goes in and has a consultation with their GP a few days later. Actually, the GP needs to know what medicine has been prescribed in the community pharmacy. Having that information on that single shared record would mean that they would have that information to hand immediately. So it would be transformational, and it's very much what I think we need across Scotland.
Thank you. And a couple of other people want to come in on this. Jess Sussman.
I'm going to totally share what Claire has said and reiterate it. Even at the moment, we cannot see the records from other GP practices into mental health, so we can't be clear about what tests have been done for patients, what current medications they're on, things like that, without contacting directly. In addition, I would say the digital strategy across nationally would be important for this, that actually patients do move around, and it would be incredibly helpful if that patient record travelled across Scotland rather than just within an NHS ward.
Thank you. And I'll come to Julie Musgrove.
It's just, again, to reiterate exactly what Claire's already said. You know, it's really frustrating not being able to access certain information for a patient. So from a prescribing point of view, if we're looking to prescribe medication, we have the same barriers that pharmacy have, having to contact the GP practice, hoping that the patient has a list of their medications, speaking to family members. It can it doesn't build confidence, and it takes a lot of time to try and get the access to the information. And likewise, we could be seeing a patient ourselves and sending the information to a GP, and the patient attends the GP the next day or the pharmacist the next day, and they won't know what treatment we've already started as well. So it's both sides. It's us referring to others and others referring into us as well. So it's just to reiterate everything Claire said, completely agree.
Yeah. And I'll go to
barriers.
Thank you, Julie. Go to Harjeet on this as well.
I agree with colleagues. Claire's right. I think connectivity interconnectivity is key to sort of getting the actual patient benefit gains from MDT working. In audiology, also what we're quite good at is epidemiological work, looking at population needs, and then looking at the type of workforce that's required to meet that need. And I think if each profession contributes to this overall, we might be able to develop a rather comprehensive way of matching workforce to need and whilst building in MDT working.
Thank you. Sandesh, you have a quick follow-up.
Yes, Sue has a follow-up question.
Sue?
That I will...
You're speaking on behalf of Sue.
I'm speaking on behalf of Sue. On this topic about the workforce plan, it's rather GP NHS centric, and we're concerned that it doesn't include all of you about how you can feed into the workforce plan. And I was wondering if you are able to give us what feedback you gave, and what needs to happen for you to be included in this, on what you feel you need.
All right, so again, is there anyone you want to direct that to first of all, Sandesh?
To Claire to start with, please.
Claire.
Thank you. So as I said earlier, as we've said a number of times to government, we are really concerned that effective workforce planning for pharmacists and pharmacy technicians is not done in the same way as it is done for other professions such as doctors and nurses. It is a significant gap and it needs to be addressed. And linked to that, we have to consider the Health and Care Staffing Act to ensure safe levels of staffing right across pharmacy. And we also think it needs to be effective workforce planning needs to be looking to the future. So it isn't just about an analysis of the numbers of pharmacists and pharmacy technicians that we have right now, but actually really looking to what's the future need, and have we understood what the roles are going to be in the future, and have we considered the difference that digital technology can make, and the different shaping of services, and then workforce planning around that is needed. It hasn't been done yet, and it really needs to be. And I think in workforce planning, there's kind of two areas in particular that I'd like to draw out for the different areas we're talking about today. So from a community pharmacy perspective, I've mentioned the Pharmacy First service, which is a really important service for improving accessibility to care for patients. There is an extension to that service, Pharmacy First Plus. It is a service that involves pharmacist prescribers, and it's only available in community pharmacies where the pharmacist is a prescriber. And that means that if a patient regularly goes to a pharmacy that they know well and their pharmacist is a prescriber, they've got access to that service and they understand it. If perhaps they go to a different pharmacy where the pharmacist isn't a prescriber, then it can lead to a frustration that the service isn't there. So we absolutely need more investment in training in pharmacists and independent prescribing. There are training places now. There's been a recent increase, but my understanding is that the courses are significantly oversubscribed. So there's a potential to expand that further. And then the other area is turning to kind of the GP practice side of things, and the pharmacotherapy service, which is part of the GMS contract. So again, we've got all GP practices bar 7 in Scotland have got some level of pharmacist support, which is really good. But we worked with the BMA last year around identifying areas for improvement that are linked with workforce. And we know at the moment that pharmacist clinical skills aren't being fully maximised in practices. And one of the reasons for that is a lack of the rest of the pharmacy team. So the pharmacy technicians and the pharmacy support workers to undertake particularly kind of the level one level of the service. And by having that staff mix in place, that would enable pharmacist clinical skills to be used more effectively at the higher level 3 of the pharmacotherapy service, which is really where they should be working. Skill mix and the workforce planning around that needs to happen alongside some of the other things like improved IT and improved effective team working. A lot to do, I think. Thank you.
And Julie Musgrove wants to come into this before we move on to talk about self-referral. Julie.
Yeah, thank you. It's just to say, I mean, optometry has capacity, and we're not a profession that's in crisis with workforce kind of planning, but there's certainly more can be done. I think it was Harjit Sandhu earlier had said that, you know, just raising awareness of the profession generally, discussing, I think it probably works within all the kind of health professions that we're talking about, but it's showing it as a career pathway, and also the other jobs that are available within that sector. So there's different A-levels, and that will help with sustainability of the service. But certainly with the ageing population in the future, to sustain that service, we're going to have to keep that, you know, pipeline going. But certainly at the moment, we have capacity, and say we're not in.
Thank you. Can we move on to talking about self-referral? Questions led by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I think we started to touch the conversation this morning about self-referral pathways. I suppose I'm interested in terms of the public's awareness of self-referral. You know, I think what we know is that there are initiatives out there, for example, Pharmacy First, that we've talked about a bit, and in NHS GGC, for example, Right Care, Right Place is a web resource. It tells people kind of when and where they should go. What we found in terms of some of the research that's been done around this inquiry is that public awareness isn't always high around some of these, particularly, I think, around when to go and self-refer out with, particularly pharmacy. I think a lot of people are aware of pharmacy particularly, but perhaps not other avenues. So I suppose my kind of first broad question is, how do we raise that awareness of people's knowledge of self-referral and their ability to self-refer? And seeing as I mentioned pharmacy, I'll maybe ask Claire first.
So I think it's a mixed bag in terms of awareness. So to start off with community pharmacy, and you've mentioned Pharmacy First, I think there is a high awareness of people's ability to self-refer into that service. However, we do have some concerns that awareness is more mixed in certain populations, particularly in some deprived groups, those with lower health literacy and potentially people in care settings as well. So I don't think it's completely there, but I think there is a good general population awareness of the ability to self-refer into that service. But when we look at other parts of pharmacy and primary care, so the pharmacists that work in GP practices, the awareness of self-referral there is very, very low. And that's really linked to that public awareness of the roles of pharmacists in GP practices being low. So we have never had a national public awareness campaign about the roles of pharmacists in GP practices, despite it being a contractual change. It went into the GMS contract around pharmacists having a role in practices. And it's the service is new, it's taken a little while to establish and so on, but it's established now, and actually now's the time for that national public awareness so that, that patients and people are aware of the roles that pharmacists have and that ability to self-refer into them. And at the same time, we could look at some of the awareness of services like Pharmacy First. I think some of the awareness campaigns have tended to be around a kind of a focus of don't go to A&E services, but go to here instead, rather than actually these are all the fantastic services that, that are available in pharmacy. So some more positive public awareness and messaging would be really useful. Thank you.
And Harjit Sandhu wants to come in on this, Paul.
In terms of self-referral, unfortunately, lots of NHS audiology services is non-existent. You have to go to your GP for a referral. But it's not a medically necessary appointment. Everybody in Scotland that has the ability to pay can directly self-refer to an audiologist on the high street. So there's this huge inequality in access to self-referral, which when we talked earlier on about prevention and public health benefits, leads to a health inequality because of that unequal access. And I think that's a key thing as well. And then because of the inquiries talking about GPs, when we don't allow people to self-refer and things like impacted wax or hearing loss, it also creates a bottleneck for GP services. So there's a whole lot of system effects when we're not promoting self-referral. And I think historically it does come down to this idea that the GP is the gatekeeper, but services have moved on, the professions have advanced, and there's these huge opportunities where innovation in care is not really executed well. And I think that promoting self-referral, sustainable models of self-referral would be a great thing for the system and service users in particular.
Thank you. And Jess Sussman.
I would again reiterate what's been said already. I think that those that are more connected to health services will know more about what is available and what they can self where and when they can self refer. And so in some ways it's for the organisations, a national campaign would be brilliant, but it's also for the organisations that people do access, like pharmacies, have information about other routes to self-referral to other things, you know, so where do people already access, how can they then learn more in those spaces to resource, to lead to other resources as well. But national campaigns would be excellent.
And Julie Musgrove.
National campaigns would be the best. I mean, from an opportunity point of view, the majority of the patients we see are self-referred or responding to a reminder. But I think better signposting everywhere. So whether it's within our primary care professions as well, so we're all signposting to the right place, you know, general practices as well. But it's also going into the kind of targeted promotions in key areas. So health centres, community centres, people that are accessing, that are not accessing healthcare at the moment. It's looking at the areas they would attend, whether it's cafes, you know, just general community centres as well, because that would help kind of promote just the health services, and people who haven't accessed the service before could then know where to turn to from that point of view.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the panel for those responses. You know, I heard what Harjit said about the GP traditionally being the gatekeeper, and I think people trying to almost find different avenues. I think in some of the written submissions we've had, particularly from HSCPs, I think there's still a nervousness around people who can't self-refer, or who end up in a self-referral pathway and end up kind of going from pillar to post slightly and ending up in an emergency setting, because there isn't the same relationship with that kind of direct point of contact that would be the GP. So, I mean, there's an acceptance that we probably do need to drill down in that, in terms of understanding who has to kind of perhaps go through the GP route as a first point of contact to then access other services, and perhaps for other people it's easier. And I think some of the answers already have kind of referred to that it's easier for other people to self-refer, but I think we do need to kind of look at individuals and their individual needs. I mean, is there a kind of acceptance that that's acceptable?
Harjit, would like to come back in on this?
I think that's absolutely right. I think if we look at what's already been established today, we have pharmacists, and we have a normalisation of when patients access that, and we have optometrists, and we have a normalisation of people know when to go. And I think there are some conditions in society that's at such large scale and in so many people that naturally the professions are well aligned to be the first point of contact, and audiology is one of them. Audiology, if you have a hearing problem, ear problem, going to audiologists, they can have more equipment. We've got the infrastructure, and it's not because they're more qualified than a GP. GPs are highly qualified staff. It's just that they're specialists in ear and hearing problems, and they are going to be a better first point of contact. That's not going to be universally true. So I think you hit on an important point. It's about getting the right person for the right at the right time in the right place. And I think it's for us really to make representation to say we believe this particular service is very well suited to be in primary care because it's the first point of contact. So I think audiology is unique in that sense. It aligns with eye care and pharmacy. But I agree with you, not all professions will be the same, and not all clinical needs will be the same.
And Claire Morrison wanted to come in on this.
Yeah, so I think there are some fantastic examples of GP practice staff really effectively triaging patients and signposting them onto other services such as Pharmacy First and such as the pharmacists working in the GP practice. And in particular, I just wanted to draw attention to the work of Healthcare Improvement Scotland's Practice Administration Collaborative. Because they worked with practice staff around the triaging and referral to a number of different services, including pharmacy. And there is still variation across practices, and actually looking at some of that work and seeing whether that work could be replicated right across Scotland could be a really effective way of improving some of that signposting. Thanks.
Thank you. And a follow-up question from Stephanie Callaghan. Stephanie.
Thank you very much, convener. I suppose just digging a wee bit more under the questions that Paul's already raised there. You know, obviously the big picture really, really matters, and you know, the GP relationship
is established over many years and is really key to a lot of patients. The GPs get the knowledge of their patient, their circumstances, and that relationship with them allows them to have those kind of sensitive discussions that patients might otherwise be unwilling to have there. So, you know, we've talked about the fact that there should be no wrong door. And what I'm really interested in, and this may be a question for Claire and Jess initially, is, you know, is it realistic for a whole variety of organisations to have someone that becomes that key person, that kind of trusted person to the individual patient, who offers that continuity and kind of helps them get access to all the primary care services? Thanks.
So will we go to Jess first on this?
Are you suggesting that the individual that could be the key person for a patient, a client, would not necessarily be the GP? Is that the nature of the question?
So I think what I'm suggesting is that obviously I'm not undermining the GP's place at all, but what you tend to find is that the individuals, and especially as they get older, there'll be a particular person that they connect with, and that's their mm-hmm. go-to person, you know, for advice that would say to them, oh, you really need to see your GP about that, or actually it'd be a really good idea to go to your pharmacist. So, you know, we've talked about link workers, we don't have them everywhere just now, and maybe that's part of it too. But as well, that realistically, what patients will do is probably choose their own key person, their own go-to uh-huh. person
absolutely.
That they trust and they feel they can rely on. So it's just about, you know, how realistic is it for that to happen? Is that something that is understood and is part of the system, or are, you know, we do say no wrong door, or is there this kind of push to get patients to go in the right direction, either on their own or through specifically just a link worker?
I think it would be fabulous if people felt that they had enough training and experience to be that person for any individual, you know, so people who are ancillary and with, you know, appropriate setting, within an appropriate setting, could be that person. Doesn't need to be the GP, it doesn't need to be, you know, the practice nurse, absolutely, so long as they have the confidence to know where to guide the, you know, the person and when, and to have that training, and if they've got the engagement, that's probably, to me, as someone in mental health, the most important thing is the engagement and the relationship and the trust, the ability to build trust with an individual. And so the training bit is additional to that, and it should be something that we can provide, you know.
And how do you, I think it'd
be a wonderful thing.
Sorry, Jess, I spoke over you there. Didn't mean to. I'll bring in Harji and then Claire.
I think it's right. I think the GP will remain one of the key, if not the key person, in a person's overall integrated care in the future. I think where the difference is, for example, in audiology, the audiologist helps that person hear, so all their healthcare interventions are that much easier to go through. But also, because audiology normally look after a long-term condition, that relationship has an opportunity to build up. The audiologists are more likely to be the kind of person, because they're seeing the people regularly, that come, you know, the service user shares more with them. And that's why that connectivity that we talked about early on, about enabling people to move seamlessly through the system, will be key as well. A joint patient record and so on, and that integrated care. But I think, following on what Jess said, it'd be great to have more healthcare professionals that service users trust in to share that information, and for all of us to work together to get a person to the right place at the right time.
Mm. And another thing we have heard, just, you know, listening to Harji, is that patients not having to tell their story multiple times as well has come up in quite a lot of not just this inquiry, but many inquiries that we've done. Claire, can I bring you in?
Yeah, so really just to reiterate how important it is to take that person-centred approach, because where a person has a relationship with someone and wants to use a particular health professional as their first point of contact into the service, then we should really try and enable that. What we saw during the COVID pandemic was where community pharmacists continued to have their doors open, we saw an enormous increase in the number of people who were coming in and making requests about how to access different services. So actually, many pharmacists already have those good relationships with people. They may not be able to provide the care, but they can signpost people on to the care that they need. And that really brings in one of the other kind of really key enablers that we need. So I've mentioned the single shared patient record already. That is the most transformational thing that we could have in place. but actually we could also have a referral mechanism. So I think one of the barriers sometimes to signposting and moving people around between different members of the multidisciplinary team is a fear that it will add time into the patient's journey, and a fear that what happens if a referral is made and actually the patient needs to go somewhere else. So if we had a really clear mechanism, a direct referral mechanism from pharmacy to GPs, for example, that would enable the patient journey to be really smooth, so that if the practice, for example, was to triage and the patient, the staff said, actually, you know, you'd be better off in your community pharmacy sees them and thinks, well, in this particular case, my professional opinion is they need to see a GP. There needs to be a really fast and smooth method to enable that to happen so that the patient hasn't waited an extra day, for example, as a result. So I think, and I think that could be achieved through a single shared record, but I think it could be achieved in other mechanisms as well.
Emma, you had a question picking up on something that Claire said there.
Yep, thanks, Convener. Just directly, Claire, to you, there's a system called ALICE, which is the Local Information System for Scotland, that is used to signpost to local services, for instance. Is that something that pharmacists use?
I am not aware of pharmacists using that, but I can check and come back to you.
It'd be interesting to know if any of the other people on our panel are aware of ALICE and what it provides as well. And maybe Julie wanted to come in anyway on Stephanie's question. Can I bring in Julie on that and you can let us know whether or not ALICE is something that's on your radar?
Unfortunately, I'm not aware of ALICE. I just want to just agree with Claire, just on a referral mechanism. You know, this definitely, it would avoid patients repeating themselves. It's also making sure that the information is passed accurately between, sometimes if a patient is given information and advised to go and see an optometrist, it's then lost in translating the information that they were going to be passing across. So that would ensure kind of information is consistent and accurate between kind of health professionals. And also, just to reiterate what Claire said, not delaying the treatment either. So that would be another kind of bonus with having the referral mechanism.
Thank you. And Jess wants to come back in.
It was about ALICE. I think one of our social workers referred to ALICE on one occasion, and when we tried to use it, I think it was either some things had shut down or things that we were aware of in the local community were not on the system. So it was about, you know, how useful these resources are if they're not, you know, centralised, consistent and continuously updated.
Yeah, and if they're not updated, you'll never go back and use it again. Can I, Stephanie, you, we have talked about the single electronic patient record, but do you have a follow-up on this issue for our panel?
Yes, I do, Convener, and I think it was... It's very, very clear that everyone across the panel agrees that, you know, it would be transformational. It would be just a massive benefit. So what I wanted to ask is, where are we right now as far as patient record sharing is concerned? And what progress do you see in plans to improve the patient record sharing? What plans do you see actually coming along in the future? What do you know is coming so far?
And do you want to direct that to anyone in particular?
Not anyone in particular, actually, just whoever feels it's most appropriate.
So we've got in the chat box, we've got you prompted there. Jess Sussman wants to come in on that.
So at least I can tell you a little bit about the borders, just from my own working perspective, is at the moment mental health services is using the same system as the GP practices, but it is for individual GP practices to choose to share their data and information with us. But obviously in other boards, the system that is being used by GPs is different from the system being used by mental health services. And crazily in the borders, the system, the IT system being used for patient notes for mental health services is not the same as the one being used for medicine and surgical services. So it is not very joined up at the moment, and it would be very hard to share electronic records across different platforms.
Is there any sign of that abating then, Jess? Are there any plans in place to rectify it that you're aware of?
Well, within mental health, we have a national digital leads group. So there are individual clinicians within each board who've been identified. Some are being given time in their job plan to do that. Most people are not. And they meet regularly to try to think about how nationally we can unify the digital systems. That's within mental health care. That's not GP and then medicine and surgery. I think what we'd all like, as I said before, is a national platform that meant that everybody was on the same platform, speaking the same language, and then you can say yes and no to whichever groups, you know, are relevant at the time to that individual patient.
And can I come to Julie Musgrove?
That's great.
Hiya, so within optometry, so we can access the last eye examination date within other optometry practices. That's the only information we can even share between optometry practices. It doesn't even tell you where the person was tested, it just gives you the date that they were tested. There is a system in Grampian, we're trialling an electronic record alongside secondary care ophthalmology. So the idea is that if we see an emergency appointment, we can enter information on this record card and it can be shared with ophthalmology, and likewise ophthalmology can share information back. That is being trialled in Grampian at the moment. I think just to reiterate what Jess said, the biggest barrier is the systems. It's system to system linking. And I think at the moment with so many different systems, and then adding in different referral mechanisms, we're just repeating information, which is time consuming. You're copying and pasting across different systems as well. So I think that is a big barrier, and it's kind of obviously time consuming and kind of costly with that. Well, but there's still a lot of work to be done, but there are some trials going on in different health boards around that.
And can I bring in Claire, and then I'll need to move on to our final line of question. Oh, sorry, Sandesh, you want to come in. Sorry, I'm getting a little bit beyond myself. We'll come to Claire, and then we have a follow-up question from Sandesh, and then we can move on to our final theme. So, Claire, over to you.
So community pharmacists do have access to the emergency care summary, although there are issues with logins. So different login in each health board. And if you are a local and move around, you can often end up with many, many different logins. I think that's something that affects a number of professions. In, I think, three boards, it's either two or three NHS boards, pharmacists can have access to the clinical portal as well, which gives some wider access. Again, an issue with logins, but actually the fact that that isn't available across Scotland means patchy information. And then, in addition, there are a small number of GP practices who have enabled remote access into their clinical systems for their local pharmacy teams as well. In all of these, issues could be overcome with a single shared record. And just to pick up one of the earlier points, one of the issues, I think, with achieving a single shared electronic record in the past has been we've really focused on trying to get systems to talk to each other. So if you think about all the many, many different clinical systems there are out there across all of health and care, it was really difficult to enable them all to speak to each other. So if we look at a cloud-based system where each of the individual clinical systems writes into a cloud-based system, so they're only writing into one place, and then equally, each profession reads from within its own platform, its own system as well. So rather than getting hundreds of systems to talk to each other, you're getting every system to talk to one thing and one central platform. And I think that is almost certainly the way that we can make some progress in the area, in the way that we've just spent years not being able to achieve this in the past.
Thank you. Sandesh, you have a follow-up question for Jess.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, directly to Jess. Just on your point about mental health systems, in Glasgow, our CAM service has a different system to our general psychiatric service. So that means when I was covering CAMs, I couldn't see patient records. I needed my nurses to open the records so I could read them, and I needed my nurses to type my notes into it because I didn't have ability to do that. Worse still, GPs can't read what psychiatry has written, and obviously you can appreciate the importance of GPs and psychiatrists being able to read our notes. And I feel this is dangerous. So what can we do quickly to overcome this?
It appears to me that some of the, at least in the borders, I know that, so the system in Glasgow is EMIS. We use the same system in the borders. We got it after Glasgow got it, so we can benefit kindly from Glasgow supporting us to use some of their additional platforms. It's a nightmare system at the moment for everybody involved. My understanding from the reason that we can't read some of the, we don't share some of our records with the GPs in the borders is because of GPs being concerned about confidentiality issues, and that there's also there's a minefield out there. And I would want, as you do, all these records to be available to everyone at the points at which they need to access them confidentially, as you'd expect. I don't know exactly what the answer is, except to say that we need to relook at the whole thing, because, of course, again, boards are buying these platforms individually as well, and then adapting them individually. It doesn't make any sense to me, especially mental health care, where people move around quite a lot, especially when unwell. You know, my patient recently ends up in Aberdeen, and, you know, they didn't have any records for the patient. So these kinds of things happen a lot. I think it's a national issue and needs a national answer. Just as you're saying about child psychiatry versus general adult and your systems, our social workers are using a totally different system to us as well. So they have to write twice if they want to give us information. The whole system is not working. It is broken and it's not efficient. I agree with you.
Thank you. We must move on to our final theme, which is around inequalities. Already been mentioned a few times by a number of you, so we're going to drill deeper into that. And these questions are led by Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. And thanks for your answers to the previous questions. It's been very helpful. Yes, the questions are around inequalities, and I know that you've all touched on this theme already. And is there a risk that increased use of alternative pathways to primary care could exacerbate health inequalities? And I know that you've all touched on it, but I would maybe like to pose this question to Claire first, and if anybody else wants to come in.
So I think I'd start by talking about community pharmacies in particular being in communities right across the country, and how important that is in terms of that accessibility to all populations, and actually is really a service that helps to address health inequalities in many ways. I think that we do need to address some of the information that we provide. So one of our concerns is around the Pharmacy First service, for example, whereby we don't have the guarantees that we actually are reaching all populations. So particular people with lower health literacy, for example, have they got the information? Do they understand about the service they can access in a pharmacy? Having said that, people, when they walk into a pharmacy, will be told about services as well. So hopefully, if they are coming into the community pharmacy because it's in their locality, then hopefully that's a way of tackling health inequalities. I think you also have to look at the range of services that are available as well, and some of the services that pharmacy provides already can help tackle some of the inequalities that exist, particularly looking at some of the services around drug use, for example, and the public health services that are available in community pharmacies as well. I think community pharmacies are a way to improve accessibility rather than to add to health inequalities. But we must just ensure that the information is there and it's available to everyone. And finally, just I suppose to touch on digital inequalities, because that's become increasingly important over the past 2 years. We know there are a lot of people who really embrace digital services and how that is improving access to services, so particularly for people in really remote areas, people who are housebound, for example, people who've got caring responsibilities. So we have examples of people who are at home with young children and are finding it difficult to get out to a pharmacy and are able to access the service remotely and how beneficial that is. But on the other hand, we do also have to ensure that we don't create new inequalities for people who cannot access digital services. So I think the most important thing is around enabling choice, providing services in a number of different ways, and enabling individual people to access the service in the way that they want, rather than putting a label that any particular service type or way of accessing it is either good or not good, and actually saying these are the range of opportunities we have and actually what's the best way of accessing it for you as an individual.
Thank you. And Harjeet Sandhu wants to come in.
fully support what Claire said, especially about that giving people choice and individualised care. I think it's absolutely right. Any system that's designed really focuses on how we reduce inequalities in access and health outcomes. I think to your question, this is a huge opportunity to address inequalities. GPs don't have the capacity to see the growing population need. They simply don't have it. And if we carry on the way we are, one thing we're going to be almost certain of is inequalities will increase, will worsen. And I think this is just a massive opportunity to really tackle those. And we talked about these at the beginning of the call, you know, home care for people with hearing loss, allowing people the same right and access to hearing care services based on clinical need, not ability to pay. There's just huge opportunities out there.
Thank you. And I'll come to Julie Musgrove.
So just to reiterate what Claire said as well, you know, I'm not concerned about it coming to kind of primary care and community. You know, practices like pharmacy, optometry practices are accessible. Every community has access to the service. And it's something that's welcoming a kind of atmosphere, and it's normalising kind of healthcare as well. When we look at the eye exams that were done in 2019, looking across all communities, it found that the uptake was at lowest at 26% and the highest at 30%. So this is actually quite a good uptake considering everyone gets an eye exam every 2 years. And although there's there is a gap between the lowest areas at 30% and the highest at 26%, that is a relatively small gap. I think it's just the biggest thing is making sure that there's an awareness out there that the NHS fund eye examinations, and also that support can be available towards glasses depending on your circumstances. So I think it's the awareness of it, but I wouldn't be concerned about it coming to community. It's just making sure we get the messaging out there that it is funded and that there is help there if you need it.
Thank you. And I'll go to Jess Sussman.
Hi. So our members talked about the economic aspects, impacts of COVID on wellbeing, and cited the Scottish Government's COVID mental health tracker that showed that the key indicators of whether you're experiencing depressive symptoms, thoughts of suicide and higher psychological distress post-COVID were related to whether you'd experienced a change in working circumstances, though those who'd been furloughed or lost their jobs had higher symptom rates in all of these areas. That needs to be looked at. The other points I wanted to make were around challenging stigma for those with mental illness, that more than two-thirds of people, 71% with mental health problems surveyed by CME, still experience stigma or discrimination, with work colleagues cited as one of the key groups. And so when we're thinking about alternative pathways and access, we need to be trying to include those with the most severe mental illnesses as well within those groups, so they're not always separated and having specialist resources that are in the distance and somewhere else, happening somewhere else to them, which is the experience I have generally with my patients, is that we have to create additional resource and additional structures for them because they can't be catered for within the standard set of options. And that concerns me a lot. For instance, you know, something like smoking cessation, which our patients would hugely benefit from. You know, your average smoking cessation plan would be maybe 6 sessions sat down with somebody specialist to talk you through the options. But for our patients, it would take months of engagement and time spent building a trusting relationship before the actual piece of work on reducing your smoking can take place, with an understanding these folk might miss a few appointments due to their mental health problems. And things like this need to be accounted for to reduce the stigma and reduce the fact they have to be somewhere else or treated in a different place. So the final bit was on parity of esteem. When we talk about health inequalities, we need to bear in mind that those with severe mental health, ill health, have one of the lowest life expectancies and the lowest rates of employment of any group. And alternative pathways need to be supplemented by wider socioeconomic support, enable people to build the stability in their lives that can secure a prolonged recovery. So for those things to be thought about in terms of inequalities. Thank you.
Thank you. Evelyn, do you have any follow-up questions for our panel?
Convener, they've actually covered off the second question.
Yep, I thought that might be the case. Sandesh, you wanted to come in on inequalities.
Yes, please, Convener. So I'd like to ask what assessment that's been made of the link between access to alternative pathways and digital exclusion?
I'm just checking who you're addressing it to.
Well, everyone. it'd be quite important, but I suppose I'd like to start with Jess.
Thank you.
So within the team I work in, one of the teams I work in, the rehabilitation team looking after people with chronic schizophrenia, we surveyed at the beginning of COVID, we surveyed all our patients. There are 120 patients in the service. And while 40 to 50% of them actually had a smart device, none of them were willing to use it to talk to us or to access other services. They wanted face-to-face contact. They did not feel comfortable or confident, probably due to the nature of their illness, to use those devices for that purpose. And they wanted the input, direct input from physical contact with us, the body language, the other aspects to engagement that are so vital for people, as most of your communication is through, not through verbal communication, but through body language. I think for these groups especially, it's really important. And so accessing other digital resources has been very difficult for that group of patients, and they would much prefer all their contact to be face-to-face. I hope that answers the question, but if there's a follow-up, I'll happily take it.
Thank you. Can I bring in Claire Morrison?
I mentioned briefly earlier, but I do think it's important, the recent Ipsos-Mori data that we Ipsos-Mori surveyed 1,107 adults in Scotland just very recently, and asked them the ways that they would, to tick all the ways that applied that they wanted to access services. So that isn't about saying they always want to access a service digitally, but they want it there as an option. And I do think that's it really goes back to what I said before about options. And so while the highest figure was for sure 87% wanted it in person, although interestingly that's 13% of people who didn't want it in person, then you've also got 59% wanting telephone consultations, 42% wanting video, and 38% other digital services. So I really think it's about enabling choice and ensuring that all of our services are available whenever it's clinically appropriate and in a variety of different ways. And I suppose the other thing I'd just draw attention to is the public consultation that took place in the summer of 2020, which was a Scottish Government consultation around public opinion on using video consulting. So that was a survey of over 5,000 people. And I think the data in that probably is something that's worth reflecting on rather than the smaller data set that I've just provided around 1,000 people, for example.
Thank you. And can I bring in Harjeet?
Yeah, so just on, to reiterate really what Jess and Claire said about choice, but also making sure that it's appropriate to the service. If we look at telephone consultations during COVID, we know that people who depend on British Sign Language, it's self-evident that it doesn't work. But at the same time, Scotland's led in providing a BSL service, which actually improves inclusion and accessibility to health. So it's really about tailoring it for appropriate care. In terms of audiology and innovation, because it's a chronic condition, lots of people also don't want to come in. You know, they want to get on with their lives for certain conditions, and they're very much welcome remote fine tuning of hearing aids and remote follow up, so using Wi-Fi, etc. Whereas some people really want that human interaction, they struggle to hear on the phone or remote. So it's all about that choice and tailoring care to the individual. And I think digital has to enhance. But it's like the inequalities test. The longer we, before we implement a model of care, we test it against some key thresholds of enhancing access and reducing inequalities. I think we can limit the impacts of digital exclusion.
Okay. Sandesh, if you've got anything you want to follow up on? Thank you very much. We have really enjoyed listening to you this morning, and thank you for everything that you've told us. Lots for us to think about, and really interesting to see there's really common themes running throughout all your services and disciplines. We're going to suspend to allow our next panel to onboard, and we're going to take a 10-minute break. Thank you. Thank you. We now come to our second panel of witnesses given evidence this morning as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And I'd like to welcome to the committee joining us remotely. We have got Alison Kerr, the Professional Practice Lead of Allied Health Professionals Federation Scotland, and Dr Graham Marshall, the Clinical Director of Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership. Good morning to you both. I don't know how much you heard of the panel beforehand, but some of the issues that were in questioning that we put to them will be put into you. And I guess I'll start off where I started at 9 o'clock, when talking about public awareness, public perception, that shift in that traditional mindset is there, that going to your GP is the only way to access primary care. And I guess I want to know your thoughts on that. Where are we on that? Are we beginning to see a shift? Is there still some issues there in terms of public awareness? And what do we do to address them? So, yeah. Big questions to start with, and probably a theme that will go throughout our time this morning. Can I come to Alison first of all?
Yes, good morning, and good morning, committee. My title's not quite right, so I'm here today in my capacity as chair of the Allied Health Professions Federation of Scotland, and I am the professional practice lead of the Royal College of Occupational Therapists. They've got merged together.
We've so made you into a hybrid. Right, okay, so apologies for that. Thanks for putting this right.
Thank you. So I'm here today on behalf of the Allied Health Professions Federation in Scotland, which is a group of 12 professional allied health professional bodies, and the HPFS is there to provide collective leadership and representation on bodies on issues that are common to EHPs. So I think, and I listened to the previous debate, it's interesting around our perception around access to primary care and GPs. So I think the world is changing, but we live in a patchy world at the moment. So for example, if you were to contact NHS 111 and ask around back pain, they would refer you back to a GP at the moment because there isn't physiotherapy coverage in 100% of GP practices in Scotland. So where there is GP coverage in the practices, that would be appropriate, but often the callers have to go back through a GP because there isn't coverage in all of these areas. And what we know around perception is that the people who see the physiotherapists are really happy. So recent figures from Glasgow show that 92% of people who saw a physiotherapist would recommend them to somebody else, and they were happy or satisfied that they saw a physio as the first point of person that they saw. The other issues from your committee inquiry, it says, there's a quote that says, you may only be aware of the practitioners when your family needs them. And I think that's some of the issues. So people don't know what else and who else does other things if you've never experienced them before. And if we add that to our patchy picture around Scotland, where you might see a physiotherapist in one practice, you might see an occupational therapist in another practice, you might see a podiatrist or a speech therapist in a different practice, but that isn't consistent across Scotland, it becomes hard for us to get our messaging together because people don't experience the same thing across the country. Thank you.
Thank you, Alison. And I'll come to Dr. Marshall.
Yes, hello. I suppose, although I'm CD in Glasgow City, I'm mainly here as a drawing GP. I think I'm a GP in Gordles Health Centre in Glasgow for nearly 30 years now. I suppose I'm an example of what happened to me recently. I was asked to visit to talk to a relative of a lady who was struggling at home. She hadn't fallen, but was at risk of doing so, and she was struggling with her Zimmer at home. And I said, great, I've got a rehabilitation team in Glasgow that's full of physiotherapists, occupational therapists, nurses, dietitians who can come out and see your auntie and get her back on her feet and try her best with her. And she says, no, I want you to visit. And I said, well, why is that? I said, because they're not doctors. Yeah. And there's that perception out there, and that's a wrong perception, but it's genuinely there. And I think that I work closely with the physiotherapists. That's one of my responsibilities in Glasgow City. And I know the figures that Alison was talking about, and I see them, and I know how valued physios are by the patients when they get hold of them. So I back up what Alison said. The public perception is changing, it is slow, people, then another example is optometry. The experience my patients get from optometrists in Glasgow City is excellent. My colleague Frank Monroe, who I work closely with, sees my patients and provides them a massively better service than I do. He knows much more about eyes than I would ever could. I did a 10-week course nearly 30 years ago in eyes and have a small light in my wall. He's got slit lamps, he's got computers, he's got years of expertise. You're much better seeing the correct professional than just going through the GP. How we change that? Okay, there's got a few ideas, but I'll let you ask the next question.
Oh, I'm quite happy for you to talk about the ideas, because that really is my next question. You know, and we all are nodding along as you're saying that, you know, there are certain people who also, like, think the GP is it, and I demand to see a doctor, and I want to see a doctor, and looking upon perhaps these other specialists as being a lesser option or been fobbed off or whatever. And you're always, I suppose, going to have that with maybe even a certain demographic, even particularly older people who've had that traditional, the way that they've lived their lives throughout their lives has always been access to a GP. But in terms of giving the public confidence that alternative pathways don't mean a lesser service, what do you think more could be done while we're on the subject, Dr. Marshall?
Okay, so I hear a lot of my colleagues saying, no, we need to advertise this more, I need to advertise that more. I don't think that would work. I don't think if you're national ads on TV or radio, whatever, saying, oh, we're going to see your optometrist, they're a better option. I don't think that's overly convincing. I think that multidisciplinary working is what we do. We used to put in context about when I started nearly 30 years ago, we saw standing our silos, practice nurses were just starting. It wasn't really an option outside of GPs. Now, even 10 years ago, we were quite siloed. I did my work, my nurse did her work, the district nurses did their work, pharmacists worked in their surgeries. Now, there's lots of different professionals who tend to work together, and it's not just multidisciplinary team meetings, it's working as well. I work with closely with pharmacists and CPNs and my rehab team and my district nurses and my practice nurses and my Scottish Ambulance Service, ANPs, we all kind of work together. And this almost a gradual response to us learning and working together so we can get patients seen by the correct person on a day-to-day basis is the way forward, I think, so that patients are introduced to the whole concept of a team rather than just an individual running a service is the way forward, I think.
Yeah. And certainly got experience of that in a change to a GP service that I had locally. It was one of the most difficult public meetings I ever had. But ever since, people have generally got a good feeling about it because they know that they get that service when they go to see a nurse practitioner or a physio within the practice, that they're getting that specialist care. So the nervousness about that kind of like different strands has abated somewhat. Can I come to you, Alison Keir, from your perspective on the question I just asked about, you know, what can we do to have better public understanding of the options, but also confidence in the options that are out there?
Yeah, I absolutely agree with Graham. I think that MDT working is key, and it's about different members of the team being seen as appropriate different pathways. They're the right people to see. So we're not an alternative to a GP, but we're the right person in the right place with the right skill set to help you. And that is about experiencing that and for the team to be confident in that, to share that experience with our service users. And also an understanding that health is not all about medical needs. So the social determinants of health impact hugely on people's general health. So a wider MDT will have a knowledge of housing, the importance of working or the economic benefits of working or volunteering, and how these wider things really impact on your health and how different members of your team can impact on your whole life, which impacts on your health in a more general sense.
Thank you. And a good springboard to talk in more depth about multidisciplinary teams. We have some questions from Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to both of the panel. Does the panel feel that the government has undertaken sufficient workforce planning to ensure that the multidisciplinary team will be in place to allow delivery of it to allow delivery of the GP contract? And could I maybe pick on Alison first?
Thank you.
Yeah, so thank you. And I think that we're on a journey with workforce planning, and I'm delighted that Scottish Government now have a specific commitment to improve AHP workforce planning, and work has now started on that. We need to find a swift and efficient way to plan our future workforce, because our workforce is going to look different for the future. You know, historically, we were perhaps more in secondary care, but we know increasingly that our offer is in primary care, and we need to grow our workforce and develop our workforce to meet that need. And that includes planning who we are, where we are, what that means in terms of education and placements. But it's also really important to not look at that around team members, but to understand it from a population health need. So what is it that our population in Scotland needs, and who can meet that need, and then to workforce from that workforce plan from that point? So now I'm not saying we need X numbers of physiotherapists, occupational therapists, dietitians. I think it's important for us to collectively understand what our population needs are, and to then work out who in the MDT has the skill set to best meet these needs, and therefore to workforce plan on that basis going forwards.
Thank you. And can I come to Graham Marshall?
Thank you. Yeah, so the GP contract was originally set up with the premise that there weren't enough GPs, and I think that's correct. There's just not enough of us to go around. So we thought, right, well, we can bring in other valued professionals, pharmacists, physios, mental health workers, links workers, et cetera, to take some of this work from our hands. Turns out there's not enough pharmacists or physios or dietitians or mental health workers either. So thinking there's a workforce out there to supplant us is just false. And there has to be workforce planning to bring these people in. Now, it can't be tomorrow, because these are highly trained people who require years and years of training, and then lots and lots of work experience to get to the standard you require to meet the service requirements. So it's not tomorrow that can come along. So although the GP contract was in general a good idea, the thought that maybe we should have looked at who was available to take on these roles might have been useful at the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian.
Thank you both for those answers. Has the government undertaken sufficient planning with regards to how infrastructure will need to change to accommodate an expanded multidisciplinary team? And do practices have the physical capacity as well as IT infrastructure to accommodate the multidisciplinary team? And I suppose some of that leans into some of the data sharing that we discussed with the last panel as well.
We'll come back to Graham Marshall.
Go the opposite way this time.
Thank you.
So the IT is okay. The IT in general practice is fine. I've got a role in secondary care as well, and the IT is much better in primary care. I think there is a planning. There's planning to recruit more medical students. I work in the university as well, and I know we're getting more doctors. Talk to my pharmacy colleagues. They say the more pharmacists are being trained. Alan's going to be much better to talk about workforce planning for AHPs, but I think there is planning to increase the numbers of all these professions. But whether they all want to go into general practice is another matter. One of the problems we have in primary care is retention of staff. So a lot of people come into the roles and think this is great, and then they get, for better phrase, they get a better offer. They want to move and work near home. They have family commitments. They have good reasons for moving away. So people who become employed soon move on. There are other more workforce constraints that I won't bore you with, but it's hard to retain the people as well as recruit them into primary care.
I'm going to Alison.
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of workforce for primary care, for MDTs, we're probably looking at locality working rather than practice-based working, because often there is not enough HPs to meet per practice, so we will need to move forwards in a locality-based model. So we're covering several practices around population need. I think our experience of data sharing is patchy, particularly where we work in integrated teams. So if we're working across health and social care, as many AHPs do, we're often working with different systems. We might need to input information more than once. We might need to move between seats and offices to different desks because different computers link to different systems. It's not an efficient way of working. And I think there's definitely work to be done across that health and care integration information. For data, we need to get better around our data and understanding of allied health professionals, and we are starting to work on that. So our systems historically log very little information about who our AHPs are in Scotland. So you might know which profession you are and which band you are, but we don't know where our specialties are. And doctors and nurses can pull much more information than AHPs can. So we are in discussion with NES around how we can look to prove better data to prove who our AHPs are, where we work, and therefore evidence where we make a difference going forward.
Thank you. Gillian, have you got any follow-up on that?
No, that's me. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. And Sandesh, you have some questions in this area.
Yes, it's on behalf of Sue. Directly to Dr. Marshall to start with, but then I'll open up the question a bit wider. So in December, the BMA weren't happy about the shortage of doctors in Scotland, and the new workforce strategy seems to talk about 800 new GPs by 2027. And Audit Scotland in 2019 weren't very happy with that and threw that into doubt. So what assessment do you make of the workforce strategy, Dr. Marshall, and then to open it up to everyone else? As far as your roles are concerned, how can we workforce plan better to ensure we get what we need?
So perhaps putting me on a spot that is above my pay grade, I don't take part in day-to-day workforce planning, but I know, as I say, from being on the Clemson Leicester University, the teaching element in Glasgow, and we have trained a lot more junior doctors just now. There's a lot more people coming through. In fact, the Leicester Theatre in Glasgow University isn't big enough to accommodate them now. So we're struggling to get tutors because there are so many people coming through. I think that's a great thing. I think I'm more than happy with that. But where they go, I don't know. No doubt primary care has seemed to be a bit of a Cinderella service by medical students, and this is perhaps even encouraged by their peers. But I think that it's a great profession to be in. I think general practice, I like working in it. I think it's an enjoyable thing. I think it's got the variety, so people coming through will be able to see that, and if people like myself can encourage them to work in primary care, I think that the doctors will come through and populate our surgeries, but it won't be tomorrow. And it's the same as with our AHP colleagues. We're going to require years of training to get to be. I mean, it's good 10 years, 12 years before you become a GP, so it won't be tomorrow before that comes through. I think it will come through. I think there people have thought about this and they're training the doctors appropriately.
And can we get the allied health professions perspective from Alison?
Yeah, certainly. I think the 800 GP figure is an interesting figure that's been around over a few years. And previously there was discussion around whether that could be complemented by part of a wider MDT. And I think it comes back to the right person in the right place. And I know from, to give you two examples, first contact practitioners, physiotherapists doing MSK work in Forth Valley have certainly contributed to the GPs being able to offer a longer appointment time. So they've been able to change their appointment time from 10 minutes to 15 minutes because first point of contact practitioners have been doing different things to free up GP time. And in Lanarkshire, occupational therapists seeing people with frailty and mild to moderate mental health problems have reduced return appointments to GPs for that population by 52%. So by widening your MDT in the GP practice, it gives a different focus, a different skill set to help people, which also helps our GPs because other people have different skill sets to help our population.
Sandesh, have you got any follow-up on that? No. Emma Harper.
Thanks. Just a wee sup on that regarding general practice. We've got the ScotGem programme now that's been established by the Scottish Government as a four-year training programme to help support GP practice for rural areas. Is that something that you're aware of or that you have experience in with ScotGem?
I work in Gorbals Health Centre in centre of Glasgow, which could be any less rural if you tried. Be right in the middle of it. So I don't have any experience in working with it. I apologise for that. I've heard of it. That's the best I can do for you, but I don't have experience in working with it. I'm sorry.
We have put Dr. Marshall on the spot somewhat. Emma, did you have any other follow-up questions on this theme? Or on
no.
This one? Thank you. Thank you. We now have questions from Paul O'Kane. Paul?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I want to kind of focus on the signposting journey, if you like. I think we have heard throughout the evidence that we've taken so far that one of the barriers to signposting is perhaps the kind of constant changing landscape of providers of service. I think also barriers about understanding what's available and communication for patients. So I suppose my kind of opening question is, how can we improve people's understanding of what's available and also the communication that exists to let people know? And if we maybe start with Alison.
And I think that's a tricky problem that's been on forever and ever. And how do we tackle that? And I know Graham had mentioned he wasn't keen on public campaigns, but I do think there's a role for that at the same time, because we need the population to understand that there's a wider workforce who are the right people for you to see, alongside the work with our MDT that increases our confidence in each other to work differently. So as professionals, we need to be confident and how we work in a new world that lets us talk about a wider group of people that will help you. And alongside that, we need to prepare the population for seeing a bigger group of people. And there's also a challenge around systems at the moment where people will often wait for a long time for an allied health professional. And if we could shift to earlier intervention, so people are seen an earlier point in their journey, that changes how effectively, in a good way, we can help people, but also our language around that. So in children's services in Scotland, we've changed the language from referral to request for assistance. So referral is quite a medical dependent type term, whereas request for assistance is a much more enabling approach. And how do we get to that model where it might be a phone call and we direct you to the right person, rather than it's a phone call and you end up on a waiting list perhaps for some time to see the right person, and then it might not be the right person after all. So how do we change our systems to have earlier, more supportive conversations with people so they can get the right help or seek their own solutions sooner in their journey?
And go to Graham Marshall on that.
Okay, so as far as accessing the right people, I think that my receptionists are critical in admin, on care navigators or signposters, whatever you like, because the team's probably correct that people still contact their GP as first protocol, and then what happens? So people have to have a trust in what when they phone up GPs. I don't like the prolonged messages you get at the start of a lot of people. I phone a lot of practices in my CD role, and you get, if you have a chest pain, call this, if you have an eye problem, call this. I don't like that. But when you come through to a practice receptionist, they have to be trusted to be confidential, professional, because they are trained. We had recent training to our practice staff on signposting, get you people to the right places. Now, in strong practices, that might be like mine, I've only 3,500 patients, so it might be easier to do because there's not that many people to signpost to. But in the larger practices, although it may be complicated, it may be more fruitful because you can get an advanced nurse practitioner, you can get an advanced physio practitioner, you can get a high support pharmacist, you can get somebody who's able to deal with your inquiry, and going through them and having the trust in your calling their care navigators and your first phone call is the best place to go, I think. Thank you.
Can I just follow up on that? Is your sense, Graham, that you know that's working kind of effectively as well? That the people, when you are signposted, someone goes on that journey with that AHP or whoever, or do you see that sometimes people kind of maybe go round the houses, for want of a better expression, and end up back at the GP? Is there a kind of effect of that?
Yeah, it's only a personal view, but they don't come back to me if they go and see them. We've had a links worker recently. She's great. Everything goes to her, stays with her. It doesn't get put back in my practice support pharmacist, although they keep changing, are excellent. And again, if they've got medication inquiries, that's the place to go. They know much more about medicine than I do. And when they go there, they don't come back. So my sense is they don't come back to me if once they've been to the correct professional. Sure. They need to take care of it, because honestly, I'm not being contrite here. They're better at it than I am, so why would they?
That's very helpful.
Thank you. And David Tollins, you have some questions around receptionists, and it's been mentioned already. Can I come to you?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panellists. To what extent do the public recognise the increasingly complex of the GP's receptionist role? And it's Graham, please.
To Marshall on that.
Especially the public, I suppose, but I get a sense that people are more understanding. And just on a personal thing, we have a platform now, an IT platform, where patients can phone us, continue to phone us, but if they want to, they can send messages via our website, website to ask us questions, and then we can, from that, navigate them to the correct place. And it's not usually me that does it, it's usually my receptionist or a care navigator that do it. So if they have a question about their medicines, it does go to my pharmacist. If they've got social problems or monetary problems, they have a money advisor on board as well, so they can be directed properly. And I think that the service they get, the outcome allows them to be satisfied, or if they want to be dissatisfied, that's fine. But I haven't had negative feedback, and the data that we've seen so far is the patients are very satisfied with the IT fixes that we've got. But And the professionalism of our receptionists should be respected, and their level of confidentiality and their level of training is high. And I listened to an A&E consultant having a go at me recently because he said he's listening to a highly trained receptionist. But they are highly trained and they are valued. Maybe it's a different job. 30 years ago, they were busybodies at a desk writing down the names of people and chatting. Now they almost don't know what they do. They're always working hard. They're always on computers and doing things, and I think they're extremely highly trained and very professional, and are worthwhile listening to what their opinions are.
David?
Graham, how could that between receptionists and patients, that whole working be improved? And the reason I'm saying this is I have a practice in my constituency that, because of a lack of support from the GPs and the level of abuse from the public, all four receptionists have resigned and they will have none by the end of this month. So how could we support receptionists, and how can we, that patient reaction with the receptionist, how can we improve that?
An easy answer is training, and that's part of the answer. I think that any training is good. We put our staff routinely through training, and even though I don't think it may make any use, I still do it, because I think letting them know their values is terribly important. How you stop the abuse, perhaps? They say these strong messages at the start, maybe finding it difficult to get through to GP surgeries, because it is difficult to get through, I can't deny that. It would reduce the frustration, some kind of response to it. And I've said this in public to Glasgow GPs, you should make your messages shorter so that it's easier to get through, or press one for this and then get cut off is not good and increases frustration. So from our side, there are improvements being made in how relatively easy it is to contact your practice. But the abuse side, unacceptable, is that fair? You can't abuse folk.
Thank you. Stephanie Callaghan has some questions around the role of the receptionist. Let's bring in Stephanie. I could be wrong. I'm not seeing Stephanie coming up on my computer.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, you're there.
That's
good.
Me now. Yes, I was still on mute and my camera was still off, but that's me on now there. I want to ask about the HIS practice and administrative staff collaborative, and the fact that it really seemed to improve triage and referral to the appropriate professionals. And I'm just wondering if there, you know, what comments you would have on possibly rolling that out at a wider level.
Yeah, I think it would be valued. We took a private halfway down that way because there wasn't enough, and there wasn't the standard. I would like to train, so we employed a private company to train our navigators up to do what they do. And I think that any training, I said that any training is good, but having a high quality training is would be ideal. So rolling that out, I've seen it And that is, I think doing something like that would be excellent, yes.
And I'm wondering what Alison's comments would be in that.
Yeah, it was more, I wanted to come back in around the reception has been that first point of contact in a time of change. So we're expecting the population to know all of these changes, and the receptionist is the first person that they speak to. So it goes back to that messaging to the public around what they can expect. So that supports our GP receptionists in a different way, that we need to get the public to have a greater awareness that it's good to see different people. It's the right person. So the GP isn't on the receiving end of unhappy people who are still expecting to always see a GP. So it's not so much about the training, it's about the messaging. And I think that's really important, because that's unacceptable for our GP receptionists. But I wonder if they're that kind of first point of frustration for a population who are not fully aware of a world that's changing round about them, and how do we help them understand that a bit more?
So just kind of on that then, Alison, I think, you know, patients see very often the receptionists at GPs being the kind of gatekeepers, but gatekeepers who are determined not to keep them out, if you like, on occasion. And I'm just wondering, how is it we go about actually improving that public perception of GP receptionists and support staff there? And as the HIS practice administration staff collaborative, is that a kind of route towards that, or is there something else that you would suggest changes?
Yeah, so I'm not hugely familiar with the staff collaborative, so I don't feel I can comment on that particularly. But I think there is an MDT role around supporting our receptionists. So the receptionists are a key member of that MDT. And how do we, as a wider team who are doing different things in the practice than we did 2, 5, 10 years ago, how do we work with our receptionists to help them understand what that looks like, to give them confidence in making different offers to people who phone up?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Paul, you had a question.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, we heard some evidence last week, I think, about the requirement for protected learning time for everyone who's involved in a practice, and that includes, obviously, reception staff. And I think, you know, other people have talked about how do we actually protect that time properly. So I don't know if Dr. Marshall, you know, has had experience of, for example, NHS 24 covering phone lines and things like that in his practice, or if there are other methods where people can feel that they're getting a service from their practice, but that protected learning time can be put in place for everyone who works in the practice.
Yes, we used to have a protected learning event in Glasgow. Well, SMILES, kind of SMILES stood for protected learning event. It wasn't the NHS 24 per se, they loaded the phone calls. It was the GP of our service that covered it. So all staff, and receptionists included, and we went along to an event. It was in Hamden for the South. And we went and we all were trained on different things, and there were different packages set up for receptionists. Went to one meeting, then went to another. And it was enjoyable, and it was valued. Then it became impossible practically, because there weren't doctors or there weren't staff to cover us. So we ended up just not being able to do it because there weren't practically the people to cover us. It was a service that stopped, and we didn't want to stop it, but their service couldn't cover us. But going on that, I think going forward, multidisciplinary training should be as good as much as different things. Because currently, if there was a thing in cardiology, I'd go to that. If there was a thing on how to take phone calls better than the receptionist, we'd go to that. I think we should be trained together. I think there's no harm in all the professions going learn each other's roles, not only to see what strengths we have, but also what deficiencies we have. And I think it'd be very useful to allow discussion to take place afterwards, allow us to see what we can and can't do. And I reckon that as much as 80% of patient contact could be dealt with by anyone in the professional team, I think, whether it's pharmacists or physios, but whatever. If we train together, we're going to be able to learn together. So I would value the return of multidisciplinary training rather than just protective training. You should do it all as one and learn what we each other do. I think patients will benefit from that. Thank you.
Thank you. And on the receptionist theme, Sandesh?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Dr. Marshall, I just wanted to pick up a little bit about what David Torrance was asking about, the abuse that our reception staff take. I, too, am a jobbing GP, and receptionists allow us to do our job. Without them, we simply couldn't function. I remember coming through to reception and seeing one of my receptionists in absolute floods of tears over what was said to her. And I hear every time I'm at work things that have been said to my reception staff where they are feeling hurt and upset. Demand and frustration are leading to this. And as you rightly said, abuse is completely unacceptable. But I'd like to know what more can be done in a concrete way to protect our receptionists and to maybe ensure that this is completely unacceptable.
Yeah, because current practice is usually if someone says something unacceptable to the receptionist, they get sent a letter saying, you can't do this. In the future, if you do this again, you'll be removed from the practice list. Then if it happens again, which is not that common, it really isn't, but it does happen, then you get put off the list. But I don't think that's learned from. I think they move on to the next practice. I don't think that it's a massive deterrent. So what would I do? There are people who become recurrently abused and they're removed to their CVRS or patient service where people can only see a certain GP under certain circumstances. That's pretty rare again. Most of my patients are nice, they're respectful, they're decent. The problem that I see is that you pick out the bad apples. So when you see somebody behaving badly, you think, oh, they're all like that. And they're not. Most of my patients are absolutely fine. It's an occurrence that happens and they don't like it, and receptionists certainly don't like it, and they should be backed up by their doctors. But the majority of my patients are fine. But the ones that do behave badly, they certainly shouldn't be allowed to do it. And they certainly should be sanctioned in some way. Removal from the lists and referral to the CBRS seems to be the only thing that happens just now. But I can't think of another pathway. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. Emma, you wanted to ask a quick question on this?
Yeah, thanks, convener. Just a quick question about, I guess, whoever's taking the phone calls in order to triage people. It is the receptionist that's the primary person. But in my local work, I've heard that there are GPs that have answered the phone to triage and identified themselves as, this is Dr. X answering the phone. And their experience has been different and not traumatic, for instance. Is there somewhere where we could be like measuring that as far as not requiring GPs to be the triagers, but just to look at that kind of different experience, where is it the perception that the receptionist who's answering the phone isn't going to have a clue about how to triage, when actually they're really pretty specialists themselves? I mean, should we maybe measure that and look at the different attitudes depending on who's answering the phone?
And is that to Dr. Marshall?
Yes.
Yeah, so I don't know how you would measure that other than a paper audit. But so go back to what I said earlier on about the electronic ability to contact. Now, that doesn't suit everyone, and I get that, particularly the elderly deprived patients. But if you go on their platform and contact the practice about a subject, you will get me. You will get someone that is in the receptionist to contact you back saying, if you want to talk to someone about your health problem, I will be contacting you in either remotely or via video conference or for telephone or face-to-face if it's appropriate to come and see me about it. So that's a way of directly getting a doctor. I don't know how you would measure it, but electronically seems to be a way forward, and I would back up using that platform or that pathway.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed, you want to ask a question around link workers? Apologies. I've just noticed that Alison Keir wants to come in off the back of Emma's question or possibly Sandesh's question. Alison, I'll come to you and I'll come to Evelyn.
Thank you. It was just to follow on from Graeme talking about training together, and I can't emphasise the importance of that enough, and that must include our receptionists. So we are all part of a primary care MDT going forwards. So we support people differently. We give equal value to all members of that team. And I think that shared training is really key to how we support and consider the well-being of all of the staff in our newly formed and created primary care teams going forwards.
Thank you. And apologies for nearly missing you there. That's the juggling act of the hybrid meeting for you. Evelyn Tweed.
Yes, thanks, convener. I wanted to ask Dr. Marshall about his comments about link workers. Dr. Marshall, you spoke very, very positively about yours. And I had a wee look online when you were speaking about the numbers between different health boards. And I see it's quite patchy. Do you see the link worker as quite a key role within your practice to make things work?
Yeah, I do now know experience. I just like patients experiencing the best service that I do too. So the stuff I learned, we know the way the GP contract works, this is taken, this is money separated, so it's ring-fenced money to at least people. And originally it was ring-fenced to deprived practices, because they're the people who are going to be less socially, they're going to be less, it's harder for them to access services because they're less so wealthy in doing it. But I think it might work across the board, I really do. I think that there might be this of how easily they take and how much time they've got and how much expertise they've got. I was so surprised at how good and mental health and housing and benefits my links worker was, that I'm very confident in referring on as many people as I can. I see them as almost a, let's say it's probably almost a sensible central adult who my people can link onto and be directed to the correct type of service. And I think they're really valuable in my experience of them. But so I haven't seen the numbers on how they detract from GP workforce, and I think they probably, they might take some of my work away, but certainly they more appropriately take my work away. They're the ones who know that system. I don't know if you'll phone up and say, oh, I'm having trouble with an employer or I can't access this. I wouldn't know how to do that, and she does. So this is an excellent service for my patients.
Thank you. And Alison wanted to come in on link workers.
Yeah, absolutely a very valuable member of our new shape teams. But it's also important to consider how they can link with our allied health professionals in teams. So that might be an occupational therapist might be working on a specific treatment plan to help somebody use public transport again. So how can the AHP and the link worker work jointly on these objectives for people? It might be a physiotherapist to set an exercise programme for somebody that the person needs to get to the local health centre. So again, there's a really nice link between the AHP and the link workers and how together we can get the best outcomes for people with their everyday lives and tasks going forwards.
Thank you. Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan? Stephanie wanted to pick up on something from the previous panel line of questioning around patient data and records. Stephanie.
Thanks very much, Convener. And I know we touched upon the single electronic patient record just during Gillian Mackay's questions. But it was just a further question on that going back. Claire Morrison in the last panel and all the others agreed with her that actually having a single electronic patient record would really be transformational, you know, with everyone being able, all different health professionals being able to access things at the same time, and also, you know, social care, social work, etc. as well. And she also made the suggestion that there was a single cloud system that actually all the other different systems talked to so that that information was available to everyone. So firstly, I suppose my first question is, would you guys agree that actually, you know, that would be transformational to have that single electronic patient record? And secondly, does it sound realistic that, you know, an integrated a cloud-based system that all the different systems can talk to would be really helpful as well? And I suppose it does kind of pull in just the previous question there and link workers too, and everyone having access to all the information. Thanks.
I'll go to Alison Keir first.
Yeah, I mean, I think the single patient record is a great idea. It's empowering. It lets the individual be absolutely the heart of the things that are important to them. My knowledge around a single cloud system, it's not good enough to comment on that. I think a system that brings things together into one place can only be better for the individual, and a safe place where that can be retrieved, because some people will have more trouble managing their own records than others. Some people find it easy, some people find it hard. So we need a safe backup, and perhaps the cloud is our new solution to do that. But if we're thinking about empowering self-management, helping people think about their own health, a single patient record is certainly a part of that journey, I believe.
And can I go to Graham now?
Yeah, you'd be mad not to think it's a good idea. There is quite a lot of transfer of information. I can go on clinical portal and see what happened in secondary care. When we talk to patients who are being referred to our Money Matters or our link workers or our HP colleagues, we tell them we're going to share this information. Is that okay? And there's sometimes that's written down and sometimes it's verbal, but there is a good share of information certainly within primary care. Would I like to see what's happening in Care First and social care? Yeah, absolutely. I think that we have used to have multidisciplinary team meetings. I would love to have access to Care First. I'd love to have access to social care. If that wasn't available, then having that available to be great, because if someone's only at home, you need to know what's happening in the social care. If someone's got child protection issues, you need to know what's happening, and that to make appropriate decisions. Because I kind of see it like playing a football team. We'd be playing in one pitch and say, well, social care, I used to go to Tannadice, so they play at Dens Park. I can't access them. They're across the road. So with some access to the whole system would be fantastic. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks very much. I think we all know the joys of copy and paste and stuff as well, and we'd rather avoid it. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you, Stephanie. And now some questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. I'm interested in social prescribing, also known as community prescribing, and we did an inquiry in the previous parliamentary session. Both David Torrance and I were members of the Health and Sport Committee as part of that inquiry, and it was talking about social prescribing being an investment and not a cost. So I'm interested to hear whether you think there's scope for wider use of social prescribing.
And will we go to Alison Kerr first of all?
Thank you. Absolutely, I'm interested in social prescribing around how we offer different solutions to people to help them achieve good health and wellbeing. So whether that is community walking groups, leisure centres, cooking classes, these are all the things that we need to do in our general life, but also the things that keep us well. So thinking about health in a much broader sense rather than just traditional medicines prescribing, it's being able to access that wider selection of things that we need to do and want to do, but actually let us be living the best life that we possibly can. So I think social prescribing is important, highly appropriate and good for people going forwards.
And we'll go to Graham now.
Yes, so my experience in this is via our health improvement colleagues who introduced a social prescribing element to their piece of our primary care improvement plan in Glasgow. It was a pilot, but it was excellently welcomed by them and the GPs in the Northeast who took on board and ran with some of this, and it's good outcomes as far as patient satisfaction. But again, whether it reduced workload or whether it they definitely improved care and they definitely improved the satisfaction of people to availability. And of course, this link workers are going to be pivotal to this if we're making these referrals or making these prescription issues, because they know the service. And because in Gorbals, it's been huge amounts of third sector things available to us. I just don't know about it. When my son went to a music session down in Gorbals, I've never even heard of the place, and I've been there in like 30 years. I just don't know it. So having people with the knowledge out there to prescribe is an important point. I can ask someone else to do that.
Just to go back to Graham, the link workers, are if they're the ones that are signposting people, are they using the ALICE system, which is the national government funded local information system for Scotland? And I'm aware of, like, so there might be issues of keeping it up to date, for instance. So that's my first question. Are the link workers directing people through ALICE or using it themselves? But also in Dumfries and Galloway, they basically dinged ALICE and set up their own DG locator so that it was updated at a regional level rather than national. So any thoughts about how do we direct people, and is it the link worker's job to link into the ALICE system or other systems?
Yeah, the issue with ALICE is such a massive piece of work, because it needs TripAdvisor, but it needs people to know what's the good part about it and what's the bad part about it, and that's done through local knowledge. And I know they have frequent meetings. We're very well coordinated, the links workers, through Cathy, and they talk to each other and find out what's best, and find out what's best in the area. There are more than one links worker in each postcode, and they find out what's the most appropriate service and what works best and what's the most effective service in doing it through local, I think, than doing it through ALICE, which is, I understand, is a massive piece of work and a massive resource you need to know local knowledge of what's best. So I read something like what's happened in Dumfries and Galloway, but even on a postcode to postcode basis, going to work best.
And we'll come to Alison on that.
So I think the use of Alice is there, but it's patchy. Some people use it, some people don't use it. Sometimes it's up to date, sometimes it's not. But I think it's how do we think about empowering people? So it might not be that we use people to access people services on their behalf. How do we help people have the skills to access services in their own right? And that's often where kind of goal setting through an intervention from an allied health professional can help you regain skills that perhaps you've lost. So there's two levels. There's somebody who will do it for you, and actually there's also a need where we help to work with people, help them do it themselves. And that's absolutely a role of EHPs who work in a real assets-based approach, helping people work on the things that are easy for them to regain their productivity and be active participants in their life again.
Okay, just another question. I'll just put them both together. We know that social prescribing, so whether it's singing in a choir for pulmonary rehabilitation, we know that works and it helps people feel good, as well as walking football and things like that. So we know that it works, but are we measuring the benefits accurately enough? And is there a risk that social prescribing will then be seen as a replacement for what's perceived as more appropriate care?
Mm. We had a very interesting response in our survey that someone said that they would be offended if they were given any social prescribing.
Yeah.
So that's always in the back of our mind. Can we come to Alison first?
I think the important thing is a kind of outcome-focused approach to anything that we do. So what matters to you as the individual must be the starting point of any intervention. And for some people, the most important thing will be singing in the choir. It might be reading their child a bedtime story. It might be going to work. So it's understanding that that is what drives the person and then working out how we meet that need. And that may be done in part through social prescribing to help them achieve an interest. But it's also about the whole wider team taking that whole premise of what matters to you. So that comes through everything and every discussion that we have. So it's seen as not an alternative, but as true listening, that we're there to help you achieve the things that are important to you. Right place, right person, right time. So that's the important approach to take going forwards.
And can I come to Graham?
Yeah, kind of what Alison said, but with the proviso that experience makes a difference, and I've already said it in this call, my experience of having come across services and realising how good they are, it would equally apply to patients when they come across it and realise that pulmonary rehabilitation is great. I used to co-chair the respiratory MCM for Glasgow and Clyde, and I found out, and I didn't really know about pulmonary rehabilitation, and I found out how good it is and its outcomes and how much difference it makes. And it's one of the only things in COPD that keeps you alive, living longer, and understanding that and realising that is so important. I think patients, although it has to be patient-centred, as Alison says, if they come across how good these services are, then they might come to accept it more.
Thank you, Emma.
Thanks, that's good. Thank you.
We're now going to go to Evelyn. She's going to lead in some questions on self-referral. Evelyn.
Thanks, convener. Yes, we've heard much about the public maybe not knowing much about self-referral, how to, etc. So really the question's around how do we do it better? How do we get the message out? And I would like to ask maybe Alison first.
Thank you. So I think that's a challenge when our systems still somehow stop us encouraging people to self-refer. So if I go back to what I talked about at the very beginning about NHS 111, that they will encourage people to go to a GP because the services are not the same in every GP practice. So there's sometimes a default where people are encouraged to go back to the GP because they will know what is there locally. So that's a bit disabling for people. So until we have less patchy provision, that's a challenge. But the self-referral is really difficult for people to navigate through a complicated system that often health professionals don't fully understand. So if you're a person at a point of need, it can be really hard to work your way through that system. So we need clear messaging. We need that development of our MDT so we're confident of our offer and of our offer of each other within that team. That comes back to our receptionist, so actually the conversations start to change. So I think we are at the beginning of a journey that should be much more about self-referral, but it's not as easy as, say, we should just encourage people to phone up and ask for something, because they don't quite know yet what to ask. If they ask for it in Glasgow, they might get it, but they might not get it in Dumfries. And also, our teams are still developing in a new shape compared to what they used to be. So we need to continue to develop that so we're all confident in what our offer is and how we help people. And it's a much better way. The vision for the future with these extended MDTs is much better for service users. But we're at the beginning of that journey. Some people are further on that journey than others. But it's hard to give a consistent message when the picture at the other side is not consistent for what that looks like.
And we'll come to Graham.
Okay, so the self-referral for some things in Glasgow City, busy therapy can self-refer, some mental health services can self-refer, and the theory being that if patients will access it themselves, if they go through the process, then they're much more likely to attend. Don't know if that's the case, but certainly that was the theory behind it. Alison's right, it's patchy. Some practices do it, other practices don't, even within health boards. It's not a universal thing. Some services like knowing the background to the patient. So if you self-refer, you won't know their past medical history, drug histories, et cetera, that we can do it. If you get a formal referral, such as Sky Gateway, you know a lot more about the patient in the background. So although self-referral is good and probably will encourage attendance, there are slight deficiencies to it as well. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. Evelyn?
And really just to follow up on that, convener, if the self-referral is maybe not the best pathway for some people and it's maybe leading them down the wrong avenue, how can we make sure that they access the most appropriate health practitioner for their needs? And maybe to Dr. Marshall again.
Go back to the navigation point, whether it's through our trained receptionists or through some electronic means where we can see what people get. I'm not plugging this, I'm not selling it, but when I get a message from a patient, I'm not getting it over the phone, I'm not getting a kind of someone else's interpretation of what they said. I get a written, often paragraph or two paragraphs about what exactly they want and what exactly the needs are. They've got time to do it and they're not nervous speaking to me. They get the opportunity to write down exactly what they want and I can ascertain from that a much better idea of what they need and can put them onto the appropriate service, whether it's me or someone else, to try to solve their health or social care issue. So something like that would people get a better avenue to really what they actually mean and what they actually want, will allow us to direct it better. Thank you.
And has Alison anything to add?
Yeah, it's how we have these requests for assistance conversations, to how we give people an opportunity to explain what their need is. In Lothian, they use the three conversations approach. So the first point is to try and unpick what people are asking for and then to help direct them in the right journey rather than they get on a waiting list. We have an early conversation, try and help people get the right people quickly.
Mm. Evelyn, I've got a follow-up question to your line of questioning. It's very specific because it's one area of a woman's experience that happens to pretty much every woman, and that's menopause. And at the moment, that seems like an ideal aspect of women's healthcare that could be self-referral. It could be quite obvious. You fit the age profile, you're getting the symptoms. And at the moment, the pathway is through a GP and it's quite a long time until they can actually get any kind of treatment. Yet you know you're pretty much perimenopausal when it happens to you. So in the same way that we've had, you know, we've got, you can self-refer to, say, family planning clinics, whatever. Do you think that, like, the women's health plan and some of the things that are happening around menopause could be an opportunity for a real step change in self-referral for menopause care? And I'm not quite sure who would like to come in on that. I'll maybe go to Dr. Marshall, first of all.
Yeah, that sounds fair. Menopause is not quite as simple as you might think, because there are a lot of statistics and difficulties with this. So when I talk to someone about HRT, I mention risk of breast cancer, I mention osteoporosis benefits, I mention cardiovascular benefits, I mention, well, there's lots. It's not a single, it's not a simple conversation. It's not a, well, quite the menopause and HRT then. It's you've got to weigh the pros and cons. You've got to have an understanding to the patient of what they're going to be dealing with. So at the end of that conversation, I often say, I want you to take on board what I've said. Here's the round information, hold me back. So I don't want a single conversation about something that's very important to someone's life and might have different pros and cons, whether what their family history is, whether it's not quite as simple as here's a quick self-referral to someone. Yeah. Well, maybe it's me as a man that finds it hard, an older man, but I do find it.
But I guess where I'm coming from is that I've anecdotally heard from a lot of women that they feel that because it's a complex situation, that they feel that they have to have that specialist care, and often will, it comes back to that health inequalities, will opt to pay privately to go to a menopause clinic. But that doesn't seem to be an offer that's out there for everyone.
I mean, I'm speaking for Glasgow and Clyde, and our excellent Sandyford service, when you get there, run by Becky, Metcalf is very good, but it's under a lot of pressure. It's under a lot of pressure with numbers, under pressure with sickness rates, under a lot of pressure, and I think we're almost lucky to have it at all, given what she tells me, Dr. Metcalf tells me. So it's hard, and to put more pressure on that service would be difficult, and as HRT can be done in primary care with suitable practitioners, I'd be most of you ditching elsewhere, unless a new service can be funded and brought up, which would be fine. Okay. Putting on existing services might be quite hard.
Thank you. I don't know if Alison's got anything to add to that.
I suppose just around including allied health professionals in the women's health plan work going forwards, which we are doing. But, you know, there's statistics around a lot of women fall out of employment at that time. Things are just really hard for them. And perhaps with intervention from a different group of professionals, that might not have happened. So to think about the scope of help that could be there from a wider group of professionals.
Thank you. We have got one final theme of questioning led by Sandesh.
Thank you. Sorry, just drinking some water, convener. Sorry. So, yes, thank you. I just want to touch on some inequalities that we have. And I think it's very pertinent to Dr. Marshall as you are working in Govan. I asked this in the first panel. I'd like to ask this to you directly. What assessment do you think, or what worries do you have around the link between alternative pathways and digital exclusion?
Yeah, it's gorgeous. Okay. I'm under pressure now, you're knowing you're up as well. I'm very lucky in the practice to have a junior partner, John O'Dowd, who's used to be a public health consultant and has a special interest in inequalities. So he talks to me about this. As an exclusion, most folk have a phone these days. Maybe, surely not everyone, but most folk have a phone these days. So there is some IT access. But yeah, the people who are their health savvy get the service first. The public health doctors, Helen Irvin, used to say that most of the money that's put into, extra money that's put in health is picked up by the highest SND, that's who's able to access it. So yeah, the unworried, unwell that are out there need to be accessed. Now, how you do that, I'm not entirely sure, because most of my time as a GP is taken up with either, as you said, the worried well or the frail elderly who definitely need that care. But the unworried, unwell, the undiagnosed diabetics, the hypertensives, the smoking, drinking in the pub all day and not accessing me, need to access them in some way. IT, possibly, but having some kind of campaign to try to get these people in to see us is important and appropriate.
Thank you.
Alison, maybe
yes.
Want to come in on that?
Yeah, thank you. So I think around the question of health inequalities, I think having a bigger MDT in a practice is a huge asset to tackle this. So if we go back to thinking about the social determinants of health and the wider issues that cause ill health, so employment, economic factors, work, the allied health professionals are really skilled in helping people in these areas, looking at housing, helping people consider how they get back to work or stay in work, helping them think about how they fill their time, all of the things that keep us well. So in terms of health inequalities, I think that having a wider group in your primary care team is really, really important in that. For digital inequalities, that is a challenge. I agree with Graham, lots of people do have a phone and we need to remember that. There is the cost of digital access and then there's the whole infrastructure. So if you're in Glasgow City, then that's fine, but you don't have to go very far outside Glasgow before you won't get broadband. So there's pockets of no access and we cannot move entirely to digital solutions as the be-all because not everybody can access them. And actually, some people just need to see people. So we need to consider a wider range of options to support people and not be channelled more and more into a digital offer because one size doesn't fit everybody. How do we do things differently in our localities? How do we use our local kind of libraries and infrastructure that's there to offer different access to people that might not be through GP, but it's also not a digital offer. It's different ways to get to the people who are harder to reach. How do we go where people can find us so we become more accessible and more part of the population? And not seen as people, healthcare professionals are there in bad times, but actually we're there as part of the community to help people keep well.
Sunday. Just to pick up a little bit on that, I recently visited the Citizens Advice Bureau in Glasgow, and they told me that they are embedding themselves in some GP practices, and they've actually found that the engagement, so if they see a health professional says, well, you need to go along and see the Citizens Advice Bureau, their engagement and the work they do is actually better than when citizens turn up and ask for help in their offices. So I wonder if we expanded that, put citizens' advice in GP practices, especially ones like Dr. Marshall's, whether that would free up time for not just the GPs, but also for allied health professionals, because the social aspect is being catered to by a specialist service.
Alison?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's who's in that team to support people and where are the best place to support them. My other experience is carer support services in GP practices, and people might not have gone to carer centres, but actually if there's somebody with a pop-up stand in the GP practice, it's really opportunistic to pick up people at the right time. So thinking about where do people find it most comfortable to access these services, they might not go there otherwise. So how do we take them to people in an easy to access way, because that's better for everybody.
Go to Dr. Marshall.
We have had this recent experience of Money Matters coming in and being embedded in general practice. And previously in North East, we had GMAP services in North East practices, and they work extremely well. The numbers, I can't quote them, but the numbers I've seen from our health improvement colleagues are enormous. The number of money they've gained for patients, and like it or not, money helps your health. And so they make a huge degree of benefit to a patient. They're trusted. If you're sitting on a GP subsidy, you're much more trusted than go 200 yards down the road to a more for the individual. Even what we used to have in Gorbals was a separate path for all five practices to access. It does not work as well as it being in the health centre, and someone sitting in a room down the corridor who you can directly access. Now, there is, someone mentioned at the start earlier on in the meeting, is there room for all these people? And there isn't. But if they had room for them to be sitting in my subsidy and then seeing my patients, because as soon as someone mentions our social security, my mind turns right. I've got someone who can do that, because having never accessed it, I don't know about it myself. I really don't. So someone that's sitting in my practice and is trusted and has access to the patient's medical records is great. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a couple of members wanting to put forward some follow-up questions. Emma Harper first.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick supplementary about digital exclusion and pop-up health checks, for instance. I'm aware that the local National Farmers Union in Dumfries and Galloway went to the auction mart and did blood pressure, vital signs, blood glucose type checks for people. Is that something that we should be looking at pursuing and measuring and seeing if something like little pop-up health checks in the town centre, in the empty shops or at the auction marts, is that something we could be pursuing?
We'll go to Alison on that.
it's about making health accessible to people. I know for occupational therapy in Ayrshire, they had pop-up shops. So if you wanted advice about your, you know, a gravel or a ramp, you could go and ask somebody and not be on a waiting list. So it's being there when people need us rather than putting people on lists to see us. And that's the whole thing about being preventative. If we can be there more quickly, we can pick up problems rather than if we're not around, people don't access us and potentially problems can become bigger than they need to. So yes, I think it's a good idea.
Dr. Marshall, before coming to our final question from Carol Mochan.
Okay, so I'm not an academic, but the evidence I've seen in this is this, that's opportunistic screening. Just screening that has not the evidence behind it that everything I've seen. Screening has to be evidenced and proven to work. We had a system in Glasgow where we, in the poor areas, we offered people to come in. The ones that needed it didn't access it. The ones that they stayed at home, and the ones that were health savvy accessed it. So everything I've seen in opportunistic screening as it doesn't work, but I doubt my health public health colleagues who will know much more about this than I have. I will.
Thank you. And final question from Carol Mochan. Carol.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just make the point, I thought Dr. Marshall made a really good point when he talked about people having access to money and how it's linked to health. That was an excellent point there. But what I'm really interested in terms of asking a question is to the allied health professionals. I think the evidence that we've taken from today and other days is that there is clear evidence that it can help in terms of inequality in health. And I wonder just if we have enough information about which allied health professionals are in primary care and whether there is a weighting towards areas that may need much more of that support or whether there's any work needed on that matter.
So that's a question for Alison Kerr.
For Alison, please. Yeah. Yes, thanks, Gillian.
Thank you, Carol. I think there is absolutely more work needed done in this matter. So how do we link that to our population health needs? So it goes back to the point I made about it's not X number of physios or occupational therapists or dietitians that we're asking for. It's understanding what our population need is and then working out who has the skills to help meet that population need. And that definitely needs more work to make sure that fits with whether it's a greater need or a lower need, but we're not quite there yet. And I think it's something we absolutely want to develop going forwards. It's better for our populations. If we understand them better, we're able to meet people's needs better.
Carol, do you want to follow up on any of that?
Yeah, just very quickly. I know we're tight for time. I'm just wondering if you could direct us to, you know, is there something as a committee somewhere we could ask for that work to be done? Would it be NES? Or, you know, what would be your sense of where we could get some of that work progressed would be helpful?
Yeah, I think NES would be really helpful to progress this work around our sort of social deprivation, our population figures. Yeah, absolutely, NES would be a good point of contact.
That's lovely. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of our second panel. I want to thank Dr. Graham Marshall and Alison Kerr for all their time this morning and for all the information that they've given us. It's been very helpful. At our next meeting on the 22nd of March, the committee will continue taking evidence as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.